Good evening, everyone, and welcome to the Valentine Maplewood City Council meeting. Today is Monday, February 14th, 2022. I want to wish everyone a happy Valentine's Day. I hope you all gave or received chocolate or flowers or cards or whatever, but happy Valentine's, everyone. Tonight, I wanted to invite anyone listening to join us for the Maplewood State of the City address. It is going to be a virtual event tomorrow morning at 10 o'clock on Zoom. Now, I think I've made it pretty clear being virtual is not my first choice, but I would much prefer to be meeting with all of you in person. In the past, we've always done a luncheon for our State of the City address, and we've given out awards. And, you know, we have certainly pivoted. This will be our second virtual State of the City address, but please join us tomorrow. There's a lot of new information, fun information about what's happening in the city and what we're expecting in this new year. I want to thank Joe Sheeran and Kevin Schmidt for all of their hard work on making that pivot from being in person to doing pre-recorded kinds of things so that we could all still be together for this event and we can do it virtually. So with that, welcome and let's get started tonight. Ms. Evans, would you please do, we need to do the Pledge of Allegiance. Let's start with that. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Now, Ms. Evans, would you please take the roll call for us?
Thank you, Mayor. Councilmember Cave.
Here.
Councilmember Juneman.
Here.
Councilmember Knutson.
Here.
Councilmember Villavicencio.
Here.
Mayor Abrams.
I'm here as well. Thank you very much. Council members, we need to approve our agenda tonight. Would someone like to make that motion?
I move approval.
Moved by Juneman, seconded by Knutson, the motion to approve the agenda. Is there any further discussion or any additions?
Mayor.
Councilmember Juneman.
Thank you, Mayor. I have one council presentation, the public safety year-end report.
Okay. Councilmember Villavicencio, would you like to weigh in on the training? I know I saw you at the League of Minnesota's Cities training. I was at the advanced training and you were at the new council member training. Would you like to talk about that?
Yes, that'd be great.
Okay, I will add that. Anyone else? Okay. Then, council members, let's go to a vote. Council member, our order tonight will be council member Knutson, Cave, Villavicencio, and then Juneman. So, council member Knutson, how do you vote on the agenda?
Aye.
Council member Cave?
Aye.
Council member Villavicencio?
Aye.
Council member Juneman?
Aye.
And I vote aye as well. The agenda passes. Approval of the minutes. First, we have the January 24th City Council Workshop Meeting Minute. Is there a motion?
I move approval.
Second.
I think that was Councilmember Cave. Am I correct for the second?
I think Juneman had that one.
Okay, got it.
Yeah.
Voices kind of blurred together there.
I know.
Okay, so moved by Knutson, seconded by Juneman. The motion to approve the January 24th City Council Workshop Meeting Minutes. Is there any further discussion? Hearing none, then let's go to a vote. Councilmember Knutson.
Aye.
Councilmember Cave.
Aye.
Villavicencio.
Aye.
And Juneman.
Aye.
And I vote aye as well. That passes. Moving on to the January 24th City Council Meeting Minutes. Is there a motion?
I move approval.
Second.
Moved by Juneman, seconded by Knutson. The motion to approve the January 24th City Council meeting minutes. Is there any further discussion? Hearing none, then let's vote. Councilmember Knudsen.
Aye.
Councilmember Cave.
Aye.
Councilmember Villavicencio.
Aye.
Councilmember Juniman.
Aye.
And I vote aye as well. That passes. Moving on to appointments and presentations. Council calendar update. City Manager Coleman, this is yours.
Thank you, Mayor Abrams, members of the City Council. This is just a short report to give you an update on what's coming up at our next council meeting. We will have a workshop, and that meeting will be devoted to addressing concerns with Emma's Place. Members of the board and management there will be meeting with the City Council to discuss our concerns with crime and other incidences there over the past summer. And so they will be at that workshop. And then at the council meeting, we have our annual alcohol compliance checks. And we'll also have a presentation from Kim O'Brien, who is the executive director of the Rice Larpenteur Alliance, to be giving her annual report. In addition to that, we only have two things on the topics for study from the council. One is the parking space requirement. And although we have been working on that on a very long time, that's a very comprehensive study done with our outside consultants. And we are still working on that. It should be wrapped up within the next month or two. And then number two, Ramsey County, the council had asked us a few meetings back to invite staff and Commissioner Victoria in to give us an update on the HRA levy program. And that is tentatively scheduled for March 28th. And with that, I have no other announcements or meetings. I'm just happy to answer any concerns you may have or work that you would like staff to do on your behalf on an area of interest or topic of interest.
Thank you, City Manager Coleman. Council members, is there any additions or discussion on this? Councilmember Knudsen?
Not at this time.
Councilmember Cave?
Not at this time.
Councilmember Villavicencio?
Not at this time.
And Councilmember Juniman?
Mayor, I have one question for staff, I believe, and it has to do with the parking, but not the space requirement per se. But when we allow what I call an overflow or extra parking lot for a specific business, are they allowed to sublet so that something else is parking there?
City Manager Coleman, who would be able to answer that?
Well, I'll take a shot at it, but I'm not sure I understand if there was a specific example. The one that comes to mind is the Myth used to lease out the Toys R Us parking lot. And they also got parking from the mall, and they had private site agreements on that. The city typically was not involved except if they were not meeting their parking space requirement.
Okay, well, I can say what it is, and it, perhaps they have an agreement, but I'm not aware of it or what we normally do or allow. And that is the overflow lot, which was green parking next to Schmelz. Volkswagen over on Highway 36, mm-hmm. There's now a sea of school buses parked in there. And I'm not sure, maybe we do allow that, but secondly, I don't know that green parking is up to the task of holding school buses. They're much larger than the cars that they used to park there.
I'm not sure about that. I do know that I think that lot that you're talking about was the impervious paver approach.
No. It's green parking. They have mats and grass comes up in between.
Okay. Maybe
I'm a little worried about the weight is what I'm worried about.
I would suggest that if Jeff Thompson can't address that now, we can put that a response in the FYI on Friday.
Okay, that's fine.
I think the FYI is the best way to approach it. We don't want to put in that way. You'll have a chance. Mr. Thompson will have a chance to take a look at it. And look at city ordinances. So I think that's the best way to do it.
We'll be happy to do that. Thank you.
Okay. So moving on, council presentations. Councilmember Juniman, you had a presentation for us.
Well, I just wanted to publicly acknowledge the wonderful year-end report from our public safety people. It was absolutely a fabulous report. It's beautiful to look at, but it's so full of wonderful information and all the things that they managed to do in this community, and not only service level, but all the new things that are happening. And it's just a wonderful presentation of them, and all during a pandemic one more time. So I just want to acknowledge that the quality of the report, and I presume it's public safety people and some help from public communications and some other people, so they should be acknowledged as well. It's a beautiful document, but also the information is, it just makes you proud to be someone who lives in a city that has this quality of public safety. So I just wanted to acknowledge that.
Thank you for bringing that up, Councilmember Juneman. And I too would concur that it is an excellent report. And I would assume that it is on our website. I see Public Safety Director Bierdemann is on the our Zoom meeting. Can you confirm that, Public Safety Director Bierdemann?
Yes, Mayor Abrams, it is on the website. If you just go to the Maplewood homepage under Public Safety, it's the very first thing that pops up. It's a big square you can click on right from there.
It's fabulous.
Yes, it is.
And congratulations on all the wonderful work to everybody mm-hmm. who participated. It's wonderful.
Excellent. Okay. And moving on, Councilmember Villavicencio, you had a report for us on the league training.
Yes. Thank you, Mayor. It was a fabulous training. I mean, for one point, it was especially great to be able to get together with other people from around the state that are city council members and mayors. And like you said, Mayor, you were in the advanced training and I was in the first training. And so it was mostly folks that are like me that are just starting out as council members. And, you know, we spoke about a lot of different subjects, you know, some boilerplate things like open meeting law and those type of things. But we also went on to, you know, fund city fund balances. And I think the most influential aspect of the training was just kind of recentering us all around leading with a purpose and understanding that we are policymakers. And so I highly appreciate the work that the league does, and I'm appreciative of being able to go to the training. And it was great to be able to be at something like that in person, because you forget the value of having conversations with folks. So thank you.
Thank you. I would concur. It was nice to see people in person, and the quality of the training was really quite good too. So thank you for that. We have now a strategic plan update for the fourth quarter with Lois Knutson.
Good evening, Madam Mayor and Council.
Good evening.
All right, let me get my screen shared. Okay. My name is Lois Knutson, and I am the Administrative Services and Performance Measurement Coordinator for the city. One of the main tasks of my job is overseeing the city's strategic plan, and that includes reporting to you every quarter on our progress. Okay. Oh, there we go. All right. As this graph shows, we are at 84% progress on our plan. And this number is actually a bit confusing, because the way Invisio reports this number, the progress here is driven by the progress on the action initiative portion of our plan, which is the bottom level of our plan. So it is not reporting how many things we have completed. Just an example of this, we have a performance measure where we have a goal to have 70% of our streets have a PCI rating of 70 or above. And currently we are at 68.66%. However, this performance measure shows up that we are at 100%. And that 100% indicates that our work on the action initiatives, the steps we're taking to achieve that performance measure, that those have been completed. And those two measures for that performance measure are inspecting a third of the city streets each year and rating them, and also completing at least 3.5 miles of reconstruction projects each year. So even though we've completed all those things, it's showing up as 100%, but we have still not met the goal of 70%. So that's just a little bit of behind the scenes, how to get you to understand what's happening here. Currently our plan has 5% disruption. That's not very bad. I think it's the best it's probably been since COVID started. There is one performance measure that has some major disruptions, and those are related to the fire department having an action initiative to conduct home safety inspections in 25% of manufactured home communities. Because of COVID, that has not happened. There are some minor disruptions that are still COVID related. One is to establish a work group to discuss city branding, get some input from the community. That hasn't happened. Also, inspection of rental housing units is a bit behind. And then we also have a measure of evaluating department policies and procedures through the equity lens. And that's a little bit delayed, but we're going to be making good progress on that now that we have hired Common Sense Consulting, and they are assisting us in our diversity, equity, and inclusion work. So in community inclusiveness, we have a more diverse workforce. It was 9.8% in 2016 and is now at 14.6%. And that was at the end of 2021. Community outreach events. There was a lot going on in the last quarter. There was an angel tree that provided gifts for approximately 175 children and seniors in our community. That was spearheaded by our police department, but staff from all over the city contributed and helped to provide those gifts for the residents in our city. Staff continued volunteering with Meals on Wheels and Big Brothers Big Sisters. And then there was also a trunk or treat event on Halloween, and there was a Santa parade in December. We are also working with Common Sense Consulting, as I mentioned before, on our diversity, equity, and inclusion programming for all staff. We want to get to a point where we have annual training for all staff regarding that issue. Financial sustainability. We continue to be recognized for our financial reporting. We achieved an excellent bond rating of AA+, and we received the GFOA Distinguished Budget Presentation Award for 2021. I'm sure there's other awards that will be coming, and the documents have been submitted for those. Total expenditures are estimated to be at 98.5% of the budget in 2021. I think they haven't quite closed out the books yet. There's a few bills that are still coming for work that was done in 2021. So that's not a final number yet. Infrastructure and asset management. We've completed 5.34 miles of road reconstruction and rehabilitation projects this year. The goal is 3.5 miles a year, so we're well above that. This is the measure I referred to before. 68.66% of our streets have a PCI, pavement condition index, rating of 70 or above. Our goal is 70%, so we're just shy of that. But as we keep doing road projects every year, we're getting closer and closer to that. Playground inspections were completed at all city parks. And our snow removal goals for the streets are being met. The goal is to have all streets fully plowed within 8 hours after the snow has stopped for 90% of average snow events. The city in the last few years has continued to invest in additional sidewalks and trail segments as we're trying to create a connected network. And that is putting some additional strain on snow clearing for trails and sidewalks. So the staff, public works staff, will be reviewing the snow clearing policy in 2022, and will be developing new strategies on how to best provide winter maintenance for the sidewalks and trails. Integrated communication. The mayor is posting 2 to 3 times weekly on social media. And I also know that council member Villavicencio has a very active social media presence. The city has a good relationship with newspapers and television stations in the area. The State of the City will be a virtual event, and that is happening tomorrow. Also, as developments are happening around the city, there are plans to work with those development partners to rebrand the city, or at least rebrand sections of Maplewood. So, for example, the North End project, As that's happening, our communication staff will be working with them on creating a brand for that area. Operational effectiveness. We're at 86% participation in the wellness program. That's the highest trimester we've had yet. That is up 16% from where we were in 2017. We continue to maintain Green Step City's Step 5 status. And so that, what we found out was for 2020, all the documents for 2021 have been submitted, and we usually get that news in May to find out if we again have achieved that status. Motor vehicle thefts were up significantly in the fourth quarter, and that seems to be the trend all over the Twin Cities. Fourth quarter was the busiest for data practices requests. However, even though they were so busy, they were still able to complete and process 93.5% of those requests in under 10 days. I believe our goal is to be able to do at least 90% in under 10 days. And then this is a little bit troubling. The recycling collection was down and trash collection was up in 2021. That is actually the opposite of our goals. We want recycling to increase and trash collection to decrease. So there's some work to be done there. Targeted redevelopment. Staff is actively working with developers on projects in the Gladstone area. The North End Zoning District Ordinance was adopted in November of 2021. And then the London Lane project where the fire station was, that construction will include 119 new affordable housing units. And also there are seven other multifamily housing projects that are in various stages of development throughout the city. And those will include nearly 1,000 new housing units. And up to 610 of those will be affordable housing units. So that's really good news too. Upcoming changes for 2022. At the workshop today, we discussed the modification of the six strategic priorities. There will still be six. However, two of them are combining into one, and we're adding a new one on environmental sustainability. That is on the consent agenda tonight, and hopefully the council will approve that so we can get going on our plans for 2022. We'd also like to establish a mission statement and values that go along with our strategic plan. That's been something that's kind of missing as part of our plan, but perhaps we can do that at a council retreat, maybe this spring or sometime later this year. And then one thing I will be doing is meeting with all the departments to review and update their plan elements and also inform them of these new modifications we're making to the plan. So that's all I have for my report. I'd be happy to answer any questions that anyone has or hear comments.
Thank you, Ms. Knudsen, for that excellent report. Let's see if council members have any questions. Councilmember Knudsen.
Just one moment. Thank you, Mayor. Not a real question, but sometimes, you know, when there's so many things, you wonder about analysis paralysis, I think is the term. But when I read through all these pages, you know, we keep track of things that we want to do and want to be excellent at. My guess is it's just part of the culture to look at these things. I'm wondering, you know, each manager, each person, how they understand and deal with all these different goals. But it appears they just become part of our culture. So I don't really have a question, but an observation of how effective this program really is. So I just want to thank you for the report and presentation.
You're welcome.
Thank you. Councilmember Cave.
No questions, just a thank you again, Lois, for all the hard work and letting the city and you know, council members and people who are watching see the accountability of the city and how transparent it is of the just of the projects they do and what goals they're going for. So this is really clear and I appreciate it. Thank you, Lois.
Thanks for your comments.
Councilmember Villavicencio.
Thank you, Mayor. Yes, thank you, Ms. Knudsen, for this report. I think it's a great report, and I think it shows how much Maplewood is thriving in a time where there's a lot of uncertainty. uncertainty. And looking at this report, I think that a lot of us can be proud of the work. So thank you to all the staff for the things that they do.
Yes, that's a good comment. I couldn't do this alone. There's a lot of staff involved in this, probably 25. So I appreciate all of them.
Good point. Councilmember Juniman.
Well, this sounds like a repeat. No questions really, but yes, thank you, Lois, and everyone involved. It's, the report is really, I think, really enlightening, and it's, she waters it down to the point where we can actually see what happened. She understands her audience. So thank you for that. Amazing, even now we're coming off of, we hope, the last of the pandemic cloud hanging over the city, but how much has gone on and how much has been accomplished, and that disruption is minimal considering the things that one would think wouldn't happen. It did anyway. So congratulations to everybody who kept the city running like it should, and thank you for this good report, Lois.
Thank you for your comments.
Thank you. And you know, just in closing and wrapping this up, this really is quite an amazing feat that we hold ourselves accountable and we take city services, which sometimes can be a very subjective kind of a thing, but we are measuring it very objectively. You know, the fact that we have our strategic priorities, we've got key outcomes, we have underlying performance measures, and that really is how we continually evaluate ourselves as to how we're doing. And it isn't lost on me that this is not an easy thing to kind of wrestle with and take sometimes, like I said, very subjective things and put them into an objective lens so that we can review how we're doing. So it really is something that I'm very proud about that we do this in Maplewood, because I know a lot of other cities do not go to this length to really measure our success. How are we doing? And also to take a look at where are our disruptions. And I have to say, I was very encouraged when I was looking at this that we only had very minimal disruptions, which, you know, during the pandemic, the worst times of the pandemic, we certainly have had some disruptions, but that seems to be diminishing. So that's, I think, a really good sign. So Lois, thank you. And when you go back to all of the staff to rework the performance measures, should we adopt these changes tonight, thank them for all their work. This really matters that we can show our residents and our businesses what it is that we do at the city and how we hold ourselves accountable. So thank you for that.
All right. Yes, I will definitely take your words on and pass them on to everyone who is involved in the strategic plan. Thank you very much for listening to me and hearing this report this evening.
You're welcome.
Thanks, Lois. Okay, moving on to the consent agenda. Let's see, we've got 8 items on the consent agenda. Is there a motion on the consent agenda?
I move consent agenda items G1 through 8.
Second.
Moved by Juniman, seconded by Cave. Motion to approve the consent agenda items G1 through 8. Any further discussion? We're going to pull off number 7.
Okay.
And I'd like, did you have something else?
Are you going in order, Mayor?
Are you going to go in order or?
Sure, we can go in order. Councilmember Knudsen.
Thank you.
Yeah, I'd like a minute or two on number 4 and number 6.
Okay. Did you, so you're highlighting 4 and 6?
Correct.
Okay. And let's see, Councilmember Cave.
No, thank you.
Councilmember Villavicencio.
None.
And Councilmember Juniman, you already, did you have anything else?
Highlighting number 5.
Okay, so.
We're already doing 6 and 7, correct?
Correct.
Yes.
Correct. Okay, so let's start with number 4. This is directing modification of existing construction contract with the North Fire Station. And I am going to assume that this is Chief Mondor.
That's correct. Chief Mondor. I guess my issue is there was a lot of change orders. I just wanted to get a recap of where we presently are. I know that it's not affecting the total project budget, but I want to kind of get a feel for what contingencies are left and how you feel about going forward. Okay. Mr. Mondor.
Thank you, Mayor. Councilmember Knutson. Yes, I know that there's a lot of change orders on the agenda for tonight. There's a lot more activity occurring at the site. Building officials are out at the site, and as we start to try to pull the project together, we noticed things in the field or things that were overseen via errors or omissions in the design process that we're starting to really see how the facility is going to work, and that's resulted in some change orders, whether it be due to code requirements and or just functionality that we've seen, and we've said, oh, we should have thought of that. So we certainly push back on change orders where we can, but where we add scope to the project, we're bound to added costs, which are in the contingency fund. We're still tracking really well with our overall contingency and have over $305,000 remaining in contingency and remain tracking well under budget. So I take these change orders seriously and want the project to be successful. And so by the time they've been presented to you, we've gone back and forth quite a bit, and we continue to track to make sure that we're remaining on budget. And if we get to a point where we start to get narrow on that contingency, some of those changes are going to have to go in a different direction or just not complete some of those tasks. But right now we're tracking well on budget.
Thank you. That's exactly what I wanted to hear. Thank you.
Okay. Moving on to number five. This is the First Amendment to the Joint Powers Agreement with Ramsey County for the embedded social worker. Chief Mondor, this is yours as well.
Yes, thank you again, Mayor Abrams, members of the council. What you have in front of you tonight is the First Amendment. We hope there's not many amendments, but this is the addition of the second social worker. The second social worker in the mental health outreach team began in December, and we've worked with the county to finalize the cost sharing agreement for this position, the second position, which has come up to about $125,000 annually, which Ms. Paulseth has been able to find funds. The ARPA funds have allowed us to fund this added social worker. The demand has been phenomenal for this project, which is unfortunate, but we're really setting a model for the region and even nationally to take fire, EMS, and police and embed them with county resources, and social work is making a tremendous impact and really involving more stakeholders than what has traditionally been done in other communities. In 2021, in a partial year, about 9 months, the team was able to make 471 patient contacts with those experiencing mental health related illness. And prior to the embedded social worker, we were able to make 26 similar contacts in all of 2020. So the demand continues to increase. The added social worker will allow us to continue to try to match the most appropriate resource at the appropriate time for the appropriate person. It's been a tremendous partnership with the county. And I thank you, Mayor Abrams, for all your advocacy and support on this initiative, and I would stand for any questions.
Thank you very much.
Can I comment, Mayor?
Then sure. Do you have any?
Yeah, I just wanted to add what I find interesting about this is when we looked at the annual report for public safety, I was looking especially at the resumes, the brief resumes of some of the new officers and stuff. What's interesting is that when you have a program like the embedded social worker, you need a culture that supports that kind of effort in lieu of other things or in addition to other things. So when you look at recruitment and retention and have a style and a culture, you know, that includes a social worker, includes alternative responses to concerns, it's really important. So I just wanted to emphasize how important it is, you know, when you have programs like this, that they are surrounded with support. So.
Thank you very much. And in terms of Chief Mondor's comments, yes, we are really a leader in this regard. Based on some of the meetings that I've had with mayors with the Ramsey County Legal of Government, I've learned that Roseville also now has followed our lead, and they have a social worker embedded in their public safety department as well. And I still get questions from other mayors about how did we make this happen and wanting to know more about this, because I really think that this is the way of the future for public safety. And I'm glad that Maplewood has taken that step. And we saw, the first social worker started in April, and we saw that this was such a great resource for our public safety department that we added a second one in December before the first year was even up. So I think that really is speaks volumes as to the need for this kind of a program. So thank you very much for that, those comments, Chief Mondor, and your question. Councilmember Juniman.
Thank you, Mayor. I also think that this speaks highly of the type of people that we attract to our PD, our fire department. People who are looking for this kind of support so they can do the right thing for our residents. And that's something that I think as other communities, I don't know if you want to say volunteer for this or think they should be into this. I think there needs to be some kind of leadership on our part as well, that it takes the support of the people that are surrounding this social worker for it to really truly be successful. So if it wasn't for our mental health outreach team and for the, I think, wonderful buy-in by both police and fire, it may not be having as good a result. So I think it's a package. And that's why I think we're becoming an example to people that are going, wow, look at that. And so they need to realize that it's not just that person who comes and takes care of things. It's that person who comes and works with the people who are looking for alternatives. So I, you know, and I've had a couple of calls from people in other communities, and they're like, how in the world? And so, of course, I said, well, you have to have a mayor and a police chief who go after it, and a fire chief who says, wait a minute, what about us too? And then you have to be sure that they're going to follow through and work with this person. And so I think we are so successful in every way because it's been set up right, but it's also being utilized by everyone in the departments. It's just a phenomenal thing. People are just amazed. And as someone said to me yesterday, Minneapolis, take note.
Okay. Very good. Very good.
Oh, okay. Boy.
Moving on to number six, Ms. Robbins, I see that you're on the call. This is your topic. Councilmember Juniman, did you have questions about this or what? No, did
I just
you
wanted really- was,
that was me.
Oh, I'm sorry.
On six?
That's all right. Kathy and I sound alike.
Yes, no, we do, don't we?
I was just thinking, you know, this is kind of an interesting thing for a city to do. And I got kind of interested in pollinators when I learned how important they were. I mean, everybody that's got a garden, everybody that shops, everybody that wants to eat a vegetable, everybody that has an apple tree, it should be very, very interested in pollinators. Yeah. So I just think it's kind of important to highlight the fact that the city finds ways, you know, to support the overall community with kind of interesting stuff. So go ahead.
Okay. Ms. Robbins, do you want to just kind of highlight this for us?
Sure. Mayor, members of the council, can you hear me?
Yes, we can.
Okay. I was having a little mic trouble earlier. This project came out of, it actually began in 2019 when Great River Greening, and they were looking for communities that might have projects that would support the grants that they were looking to get funding for. And they identified the City Hall campus as a really great place to restore pollinator habitat and to get rid of some invasive species, and also to get rid of just turf that you mow and make it native, so there was less mowing and less maintenance. And it took a while. This was kind of held up in the legislature for a while with funding. And then finally, with COVID and everything, and the funding was approved in late summer of 2021. And then they circled back and said they were ready to look into starting to do these programs. And then as we were going through the process, you know, we had talked about the possibility of using goats for removing buckthorn and other invasive species. And our natural resources coordinator, Carol Gurness, and myself reached out to see if it would be possible to use, incorporate goats into this project. And we were happy to hear that it was, and it was very, our original cash match was $5,000 for this project. And for just $2,500 more, we were able to incorporate the use of goats for grazing and getting rid of the species and some land management. So we were really happy for that to happen. And so I'll stand for any questions about the project. We're really excited to get this off the ground.
I am too. I think it's going to be a really great project for our city campus. Council members, do you have any questions for Ms. Robbins? Councilmember Knutson?
No, thanks.
Council Member Cave.
No, thank you.
Council Member Villavicencio.
No questions. I just wanted to reiterate what Council Member Knutson said. Pollinators are important, so thank you for this work.
And Council Member Juniman.
No questions, Mayor, but again, what a wonderful thing. And this all has to do with leadership and people asking the right questions. And here we are again, leading the way. What can I say? But this is going to be great because it's another, if you will, demonstration, because it's going to be at City Hall campus. And so people will be able to see what pollinator plantings look like, and they can see it functioning for the city. It's wonderful. And then you were able to get your goats too, Mayor. I'll tell you what, it's all rolled into one.
But I think it's going to be great that we're going to have goats. What a fun thing for, you know, for our city when people come to City Hall and we've got goats out there on the campus and they're clearing out the buckthorn.
Just so totally don't mistake the goats for the city council, it's fine.
Okay, so moving on to number 7, our strategic priorities modifications. I believe that Lois is off of the call. City Manager, City Manager Coleman, do you want to take this one and set us up?
Thank you, Mayor. Members of the council, I believe that the intent here is to, let me just find the staff report real quick. I had not noticed that Lois was missing. So give me one second here.
G7.
Yep.
Bingo.
It's a big packet in between there. Okay, here we go. So I believe what we were intending to do here is just to have a motion to establish the city's strategic priorities as community inclusiveness, environmental stewardship, financial and asset management, integrated communication, operational effectiveness, and targeted redevelopment. And I think that the council agreed to that, and the new priorities will be financial and asset management and environmental stewardship, as was discussed at our previous workshop. So I think that is what we're looking for, is an actual formal motion to do those things, as outlined in the staff report.
Thank you.
Auction that was also required.
Yes, we had talked about inserting the word quality in the financial and asset management portion and ensure uninterrupted quality services. Council talked about that, but I think what we'll have to do, I'd like to have a discussion with the council and see if there are any other editing suggestions for these summaries of our strategic priorities. And then when we make the motion, we can add that amendment to add the word quality.
Perfect.
So let's see about discussion. Council, we left off talking about really, do you look at this from a microscope or a telescope? And the way that we have done it is that our strategic priorities are captured on the back of our council packets in a summary format. And then when we have the key outcomes and the performance measures, that really gets into the weeds and fleshes out the real meat of each one of those strategic objectives. And I think Councilmember Knutson was talking a little bit of, you know, wanting a little bit more on the, instead of the summary. So let's have that discussion, and then we can I think what we'll need to do is we'll have to pull that one out, but let's have the discussion right now. So Councilmember Knutson, your thoughts.
You know, I think when you put it in the telescope or microscope kind of concept really makes sense. I'm just worried about, you know, the publication. And, you know, I think Councilmember Juniman had a suggestion on the financial and asset management one that made sense, adding, you know, a word about quality. I'm comfortable with that.
Okay. Councilmember Cave, any other thoughts?
Yes. No, I agree with Kathy on it. My one suggestion is, before we go and add or delete, you know, and change too much, a suggestion is waiting until Lois goes and kind of brings us all to the departments and see what suggestions they have. If there's things that are too broad for them, or if they see, you know, we should, you know, pinpoint this or pull up this. Sometimes, you know, and I heard Lois say we can change it at any time. So just having quality put in there is fine right now, but I kind of want to get the feedback from Lois after she goes and speaks with some of the department heads about, you know, implementing this, what they feel.
Sure. Thank you for that. Mm-hmm. Councilmember Villavicencio.
I don't have any edits, but I do concur with Councilmember Cave's comments.
Okay. And Councilmember Juniman.
Yes, Mayor. Thank you. I think we should, you know, wait until we hear what they think about this. I just thought the word quality would help us bring together a little better what we had combined, but that certainly isn't all there is to do necessarily. But I think we should hear from the people who do this and have to do it and have to do the outcomes. What, if anything, more they'd like to see done.
Sure. Okay. So council members, my suggestion is that I'm asking for a motion to approve consent agenda items 1 through 6 and number 8. And then we'll take 7 separately and add that amendment. So okay, is there a motion?
I already moved all of them. So now we'll have to redo it, correct?
Correct.
Okay, I move consent agenda items G1 through 6 and 8.
Second.
Moved by Juniman, seconded by Cave. Consent agenda items G1 through 6 and number 8. Is there any further discussion? Hearing none, then let's vote. Councilmember Knutson?
Aye.
Councilmember Cave?
Aye.
Councilmember Villavicencio?
Aye.
Councilmember Juniman?
Aye.
And I vote aye as well. Now, would someone like to make the motion for number 7? With that amendment adding quality to fiscal and asset management.
I move the strategic priorities modifications and to the financial and assets modification, we add the word quality.
Second.
Moved by Juniman, seconded by Cave. The motion to approve our strategic priorities modifications with the addition of the word quality in our financial and asset management strategic priority. Is there any further discussion? Hearing none, then let's take a vote. Councilmember Knutson.
Aye.
Councilmember Cave.
Aye.
Councilmember Villavicencio.
Aye.
Councilmember Juniman.
Aye.
And I vote aye as well. The motion.
Mayor, could I ask a question?
Is that City Manager Coleman?
Yes. I just want to make sure I understand Councilmember Cave and Villavicencio's comments about getting feedback from employees. And typically we would not bring this back to you until the end of the first quarter of 2022, because that's when, you know, it takes her a while to get through meeting with all the employees. And so my question is it more that you want to hear from other employees who work with us every day about adding the word quality or adding or agreeing to the definitions as they've been defined for those two new categories?
Mayor, this is Rebecca.
Okay, yeah, go ahead.
City Manager Coleman, my thoughts on it were not the quality adding on to it, but if there was any other parts that were maybe too broad or too narrow with the verbiage for the staff.
Okay. So in order to do that, would it be acceptable to go ahead and put into our staff reports moving forward from tonight the two new categories with the understanding that we will seek input from other employees in the organization to see if those definitions make sense and apply to the work that they're doing?
I think that's a good way to approach it. And can I maybe add a further clarification here that I think Councilmember Cave, correct me if I'm wrong, but what I hear you saying is, you know, after this first quarter, when we get the new key outcome indicators and the performance measures, when we get all of that together, do we need to do any fine tuning of the strategic priority themselves, trying to get that realigned? I think Lois will be able to report that back to us after after the next quarter.
Yeah, that makes sense to me. Yes. Thank you for clarifying that.
Okay. Does that help now?
Yes, very much. Thank you.
Okay. Anything else that you wanted to add, Councilmember Cave, about that?
No, ma'am.
Okay. Then let's move on. We do have two public hearings tonight. And for those who might be on the line, this is how we're going to do the public hearing tonight. The first thing we will start with is the staff report concerning, first it'll be the Cope Avenue Improvements, City Project 2106. Once the staff report is provided to the council, then there will be questions from the council that will go through. And then I will open up the public hearing. And anyone who wishes to speak concerning the Cope Avenue improvements will have an opportunity. They'll have 3 minutes each. Once we have taken all of the comments from the public, I will close the public hearing. And at that point, then staff will be able to respond to any questions that come up during the public hearing. And then once again, the council will have a time for discussion and to consider the motion that is before us concerning this road project. So with that, let us start with Mr. Love for the staff report.
Yes, Mayor and Council, good evening. Mayor, you did a great job of covering most of what I was going to lead in with. So we have John Jaroche, our assistant city engineer, with us tonight. He will be providing the presentation, and both John and I will be available for questions throughout this process. So with that, I would turn it over to John.
Thank you. Welcome, Mr. Jaroche.
Thank you, Mayor. Thank you, Steve. Thank you, Council. First project I'm here to talk to you about tonight is the Cope Avenue Improvements, City Project 2106. The extents of this project are shown on the right-hand side of the screen there. It includes Cope Avenue from English Street on the west over to White Bear Avenue on the east. This street totals just over 1 mile in length and has an average pavement condition index rating of just 41 out of 100. Again, that's on a scale from 0 to 100, with 100 being a brand new street, 0 being nothing left. These rated a 41 out of 100, so in pretty rough shape. The pavement has deteriorated to the point where general maintenance is no longer cost effective. Also, the majority of the concrete curb and gutter along the street has deteriorated beyond repair. The Maplewood owned utilities, so your sanitary sewer system and your storm sewer system, those systems are generally in good condition with only minor repairs needed. But St. Paul Regional Water has identified that all of the cast iron water main underneath Cope Avenue is in need of replacement. And this corridor also lacks connected or continuous pedestrian and bicycling facilities. We've reached out to the residents in a number of ways so far. We sent out an informational packet back in November of last year that included a project location map, a frequently asked questions brochure, as well as information on the proposed assessments. It also included an invitation to that first neighborhood meeting, which we held on November 21st. At that meeting, we staff did a presentation followed by a question and answer session. And that presentation covered the scope of the project, the timeline, how much that project would cost and how it'd be funded, as well as information on the assessments, as well as how residents would continue to be communicated with throughout the process. We sent that invitation for that meeting out to 76 property owners, and approximately 10 people attended that meeting. The majority of the conversation revolved around the proposed sidewalk on the north side of Cope Avenue and how that would impact boulevards, what would happen to existing trees in the area with the project, property access during construction, the proposed roadway layout modifications, as well as a number of people noting speeding issues along the corridor. A handful of residents also noted that parking was necessary in that residential section from Birmingham over to Hazelwood Street. Staff also held a second neighborhood meeting just last week leading up to this public hearing. It was a very similar presentation as that first neighborhood meeting, reviewed that information to bring them back up to speed, and then also went a little more in detail on the proposed street layout reconfigurations. At that meeting, we had approximately four people join the meeting, and just some basic questions on mail delivery during the project and how that would be securely handled, as well as some questions about trees and site distances when backing out of driveways. And just a note that additional neighborhood meetings would be scheduled as this project moved throughout the process. The scope of this project includes reclaiming or grinding up the existing street pavement and mixing it in with the aggregate base below to create a new stable and solid base for the new roadway. On top of that, we would install two new layers of asphalt pavement. We'd replace all of the concrete curb and gutter along Cope Avenue. We'd also do some minor repairs to the storm sewer system, as well as upgrading the sanitary sewer manhole castings and lids and bringing those to the final roadway elevation. We'd look at replacing all of the cast iron water main as determined by St. Paul Regional Water. We are proposing that sidewalk along the entire north side to fill in the missing segments. If you've been on Cope Avenue, you probably noticed there's a number of segments in place already. We're looking at filling in those pieces with this project and making that continuous connection between English Street and White Bear Avenue. And then as part of the feasibility process, staff did look into options for reconfiguring the roadway to better fit the future, the current and future traffic demands, as well as improve pedestrian and bicycle access and safety, reduce unnecessary impervious surfaces, as well as slow and improve traffic safety along the corridor. And to do that, staff consulted with the traffic experts over at SRF Consulting Group to really look at the corridor and seek ways to achieve those goals. We also referenced the guiding documents like our Living Streets Policy, Comprehensive Plan, and the Parks and Trails Master Plan to guide that process. And this analysis did show there is an opportunity to achieve those goals. And on the next few slides, I'm going to run you through the modifications we're proposing. So this first segment is from Birmingham Street over to Hazelwood Street on Cope Avenue. So this is the residential section of the project. On this diagram, those blue dashed vertical lines, those are representing the existing curb line, so where the curb is today. And we're proposing to shrink this street from its current 37 foot width down to 32 feet wide, so taking 5 feet out of that street section. And we're looking at doing all of that narrowing off of the north side of the roadway. And the idea there is to minimize the impact of that sidewalk we're proposing on the north side. Looking at the street, it would maintain that existing 8 foot parking lane that's out there today that the residents felt was very important to have out there. That parking lane could also be used as the multi-use connection for pedestrians, bicyclists, scooters, and whatnot. Then you have the two driving lanes. They're currently 12 foot in width. We're looking at reducing those each by 1 foot to aid in traffic calming to make the corridor feel a little more constricted and hopefully slow people down. And on the south side, the 2 foot is shown as a striped area there. That's just the curb line on the reaction zone on the edge of the road. So that is the section in the residential portion of the project. Moving to the east, this one is from Hazelwood Street over to about where City and County Credit Union is, so along Knucklehead Lake. Again, the vertical blue lines are the existing curb line. In this area, the road is currently 52 feet in width, and we are looking at bringing that down by 20 feet, so bringing it down to 32 feet in width. In this section, we do that narrowing equally off both sides, so taking 10 feet from the north and south side of Cope Avenue. We'd have that 5-foot sidewalk continuing on the north side, and then looking at the street, what's shown as a 5-foot buffer lane on there, that would be the 5-foot shared use shoulder, can be used by the pedestrians and bicyclists. And then we'd have 2 through driving lanes, and again, they'd be 11 feet in width to aid in traffic calming. Then moving further to the east from Knucklehead Lake over to White Bear Avenue, this is the more commercial business area of the project. There's a number of driveway accesses on both sides of the road, so we knew it was very important to maintain that ability to turn left into these properties, as well as maintain the through traffic. So in this area, not as quite as much narrowing, but we are looking at bringing it down from 52 feet in width down to 44 feet in width. So taking 8 feet out of that roadway, again, 4 feet off each side equally, taking that narrowing off each side. In this area, we're looking at the 5-foot shared use shoulders again, 2 through driving lanes, but then having a 12-foot center turn lane to maintain that access to the properties on either side. And then again, on the north side, there will be the 5-foot sidewalk extending and carrying all the way down to the White Bear Avenue sidewalk system. And then I should mention at the far west end of the project, west of where we started with these diagrams, from English Street over to Birmingham Street, we don't have a diagram from there. We are not proposing any modifications to that roadway layout, and that is due to the feedback we heard at the neighborhood meetings in that the businesses in that area need that existing road width to be able to operate their business and get their numerous semi-trucks in and out of there on a daily basis. So we are not proposing any roadway layout modifications from English Street over to Birmingham Street. That being said, this project is estimated to cost just over $3.9 million, with the project being funded by the sources shown on the screen, the various utility funds to fund the improvements to those systems, general obligation improvement bonds, the WAC fund, and then St. Paul Regional Water Services is estimated to be funding just over $1 million on this project. You may have noticed that this project is proposed to be, or estimated to be, slightly over the CIP value, but that does reflect additional water system improvement costs that we identified during the feasibility process, and those increased costs would be covered by St. Paul Water. And then the final funding source would be the assessments to the properties benefiting from the project. So as you saw on the previous slide, the special assessments are one of the funding sources utilized to finance the public improvement projects. And each year, the City Council sets a maximum unit rate for the assessments based on the type of project. And then during the project design phase, an independent appraisal firm is hired to determine what the actual benefit is that is received by the properties in the area. And per Minnesota state statutes, we cannot assess for more than the property's benefit. And that appraisal process is underway right now. That being said, we would look at holding the assessment hearing in September of the year if the project progresses. And prior to that assessment hearing, residents in the area would be mailed an official statement of their assessment that would include the amount of their assessment, options for paying the assessment, the ability to defer it, as well as their right to object to the assessment. And this city staff would hold an additional neighborhood meeting in the fall to bring residents back up to speed on the assessments and answer any questions they may have leading up to that assessment hearing. Looking at the project schedule, the council received and approved that feasibility study back on January 24th. Staff held a second neighborhood meeting on February 8th, leading up to tonight's public hearing. Tonight's meeting is the residents' opportunity to provide input directly to the council on the proposed improvements. And after receiving that input and considering it, the council will vote on whether or not to order the project tonight. And just to note that 4 affirmative votes are required at the public hearing to advance the project. If it's approved tonight, staff would finish the design on the project and send those plans out for bids We'd look at awarding a construction contract in the late April, early May timeframe. If it was awarded, we would look at holding a third neighborhood meeting in May to answer any questions residents might have on the upcoming construction process. Construction would occur from June to October of the year, and then we'd hold that assessment hearing in September. And again, that's the meeting at which residents can directly voice their opinions on the proposed assessments to the council. With that being said, staff is recommending that the City Council hold a public hearing tonight. And then after considering the input they receive, staff is recommending approval of the resolution ordering the improvement for the Cope Avenue Improvement Project, City Project 2106. And just a final note that four affirmative votes are required to approve the resolution. With that, staff is available for questions.
Thank you, Mr. Jaroche. I have to say, for the hundreds of times that I've driven on Cope Avenue, I never knew that that little lake there was called Knucklehead Lake until I've been reading the reports on this project. I don't know why, I never knew that that was called Knucklehead Lake. It's a great name, but I never knew that, so thank you. I think our staff does a fabulous job of notifying our residents and being in communication with residents about the project, during the project, and really keeping people up to speed. I know on Cope, we've got a number of businesses that will be impacted by this. This is a big street construction project. So, Mr. Jaroche, what kind of notification do you do for our businesses?
Great question, Mayor, Council. So we recognize that this project is going to be very impactful for the businesses along there, and we highly value those businesses. The project is going to be done under through traffic conditions, so we're going to maintain traffic through there at all times. We're going to do our best to maintain unimpeded access to all these businesses as well during the project. We're looking at putting up additional signage to ensure that motorists know how to get to the various businesses throughout the project area. And then we are also assigning one of our staff people, their job this summer is going to be to go on a weekly basis and meet with the property owners, especially those businesses, to make sure that their needs are being met during the project.
Okay, that's good to know. And I take it that they're getting notices about this as well, aren't they?
Yes, so all the property owners in the project area are getting the same notifications that we are sending out. During the project, we send out a monthly mailer to kind of give residents and property owners the big picture of what's happening with the project. We provide weekly updates on our webpage, and we also hang door-to-door flyers for more urgent needs throughout the project.
Okay, one last question before I open it up to the council members, but are we notifying the property owners who may not be the people that are actually, having a business at that location? Is it the individual businesses themselves or only the property owners? Because the business could be leasing from the property owner.
Yeah, it's a great question, Mayor, Council. So we, as part of the, as we can move along the design and as we move towards construction, we're going to work with those businesses and find out who that proper contact is, whether it's the property owner or a manager of the business. We need to establish who exactly that best contact person is. And that's what our staff person is going to be assigned to, is going out there and meeting with the properties, going into the businesses and establishing that contact early on so we can get ahead of any issues, hopefully, that might arise during construction.
Okay, that's great. Let's see if there are any other questions from the council before we open the public hearing. Councilmember Knudsen.
Thank you, Mayor. Mr. Jaroche, during these inflationary times, if we get to the project and it is bid higher than we anticipated, what kind of plans do you have? Do you have to come back, or was there kind of a contingency or a threshold?
That's a good question, Councilmember Knudsen. So as part of the cost estimation, we do build in a 10% contingency into the cost estimate, as well as a 12.5% amount for engineering and overhead type things. So I believe we have enough built into there already. And we did include some, our best attempt at estimating for inflation that's coming up this year. But we really don't know how those bids are
going to be.
bid anything out this year, and I haven't heard any feedback from other cities or anything that have bid anything out yet. So don't know exactly where it's going to go, and it'll come down to when we get those bids in. We'll have to reevaluate things and see where
it's. Sure. Well, thank you. We'll work with you, I'm sure. Thank you.
1.2, I guess I just want to throw in there. It's something that I learned at the League of Minnesota Cities training. We had a legislative update, and one of the political advisors for the league indicated that there is a bill at the legislature that has actually gotten bipartisan support, and it is for a tax exemption for road materials for doing road projects. Mr. Droesch, have you heard anything about that?
No.
Mayor, Council, I am not aware of that. That's something I can look into. I don't know if Mr. Love has heard of anything about that, but it's definitely something we can look into.
Thanks. The league brought it up, and that was just, you know, in the last 2 weeks that I was at the league training. But that was something that sounded rather fascinating, considering we are doing, you know, three road projects this summer, and being able to save on the road materials certainly would be a benefit to our residents. So something to look for. I don't know where that is. I just heard about it. We had a discussion about it at that training. So Councilmember Cave.
You know, I think John did a great job. I don't have any questions at this time.
Okay, thanks. Councilmember Villavicencio.
Well, as someone who, when it's not freezing or below freezing out, I perused this area many times, and I know from talking to people in this area, whether it's businesses or residents, that there is a speeding issue in this area. So I do really know that this project is necessary, and so I appreciate that. And I think in the long run, it will, you know, obviously benefit the whole city. And I just want a friendly reminder too that when we are in the construction period to be cognizant of the city bus stops in that area, because I know there are a few in that area. And I know that during construction times, it gets kind of hairy where they are. And sometimes the translation from the Met Council to the cities gets lost. So just something to be aware of. Thank you.
Thank you for that. Councilmember Juniman.
Thank you, Mayor. This is, I think I know the answer, but perhaps is it the fact that this road has so many strange widths? And it came really close to Knucklehead Lake for a long time. Is it possible or probable that by redoing this and redoing the drainage that the road will be constructed to last a whole lot longer? I mean, I can't, when you look at it and you see how it goes, you know, up and down and doesn't seem to have a bottom, shall I put it that way? Will that go away?
Mr. Droesch, can you respond?
Yes, Mayor, Councilmember Juniman. I think if I'm understanding the question correctly, the Cope Avenue is very flat. It doesn't have any really well-defined low points. So as part of the design, we are looking at how we can modify the slopes, the profile of the road to ensure that the road properly drains.
Right.
And we'll also be adding, right now there isn't much of a crown to the road.
Right.
Ensuring there's a proper crown there to shed the water up from the center of the road over to the curb lines. Then also with the significant narrowing of the roadway, there should be significantly less runoff along the road as well. So the drainage pattern out there should be significantly improved from what's there today, which should aid in, you know, extending the life of the roadway.
Thank you so much. That's my only question.
Okay. Thank you for that presentation and answering all those questions. At this time, I am going to open up the public hearing for the Cope Avenue Improvement City Project 21-06. Mr. Folds, can we get back to, we don't need this screen anymore. Is there anyone that is on our Zoom call that would like to speak at the public hearing?
Good afternoon, good evening, Mayor and Council. We have four individuals on the line. I'm not sure if they're for this item or for the next, but as in past, we can unmute each of them and ask them.
All right, if you would do that, thank you very much.
Perfect. Caller with the last four digits of 9788. If you would like to give public comment on this item, if you could please press star six to unmute yourself. Again, that was caller with the last four of 9788. Okay, we can move on to the next one.
Wait a minute.
No.
Hello?
Hello?
Yes.
This is 97, what was it, 9788?
Yes, it is. Good evening and welcome to the Maplewood City Council public hearing on the Cope Avenue Improvement Project.
I guess we're on the phone for the scooters, so I guess we'll come back on when you cover the scooters. Is that all right?
I don't believe that there isn't a public hearing portion on the scooters coffee proposal. That's under new business. Right now we're on the agenda concerning the Cope Avenue improvements.
Yeah.
Did you want to make public comment about that?
No, so what you're saying is there won't be public comment tonight on scooters?
That's correct.
Okay, then when will that happen? Do you know at this point?
There isn't a, I don't believe that there is an opportunity. Ms. Coleman or Mr. Beatty, do you want to weigh in on that?
I will, Mayor. The action tonight is for approving a conditional use permit and a setback variance resolution and design review resolution. The public hearing on the conditional use permit was held by the Planning Commission, which is typically their role, and that was held earlier. And the notes and recommendations from the Planning Commission will be covered tonight by Mr. Thompson when he does that review. You are under no legal obligations to take testimony this evening. This is not a public hearing.
Thank you very much. You know what we'll do, I will ask the council to weigh in on when we get to the scooters portion about taking any public comment. But for right now, we're in a public hearing concerning COPE.
Yeah, I understand that.
Okay.
Okay, thank you.
All right.
Thank you.
Sure. Mr. Folds?
Yes, Mayor and Council, we'll move on to the next one. Caller with the last four digits of 7520. 7520, if you would like to give public comment, if you could please press star six to unmute yourself. That was caller with the last four digits of 7520. Okay, we'll move on to the next one. And caller with the last four digits of 1917. 1917, if you would like to give public comment, please press star six to unmute yourself. It was 1917. Please press star six if you would like to give public comment. No? Okay. And then lastly, we have Mr. Horniker. If you would like to give public comment on this, could you please unmute yourself and do so? Again, Mr. Horniker, if you would like to give public comment on this item, if you could just unmute yourself.
Yeah, no, I'm good. Thank you. I was going to wait for the Gervais area discussion.
Sounds good. Great.
Okay,
thank you.
Appreciate that. Mr. Foltz, is there anyone else?
Mayor and Council, that is all.
Okay, then based on that, I am going to close the public hearing. And now there aren't any questions for staff to answer. So let's move on to council discussion. Councilmember Knutson.
No questions.
Okay, Councilmember Cave.
No questions.
Councilmember Villavicencio.
No questions.
Councilmember Juniman. Councilmember Juniman.
Kathy, you're muted.
Sorry. I finally got it to listen to me. No questions. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. Then council members, would someone like to make a motion? And just a reminder that 4 affirmative votes are required to approve this project. Can someone make a motion?
I move to approve the attached resolution.
Whoops.
Go ahead.
Oral response.
It sounded like a choir.
Yes.
Isn't that cool? Go ahead, Kathy.
Okay. Thank you. Motion to approve the attached resolution ordering the improvement for the Cove Avenue Improvement City Project 21-06.
Second.
Moved by Juniman, seconded by Knutson. The motion to approve the attached resolution ordering the improvement for the Cope Avenue Improvements City Project 21-06. Is there any further discussion? Hearing none, then let's go to a vote. Councilmember Knutson.
Aye.
Councilmember Cave.
Aye.
Councilmember Villavicencio.
Aye.
Councilmember Juniman.
Aye.
And I vote aye as well. The motion passes. Thank you very much. And now we move on to our second public hearing concerning the Jarvis Area Pavement Rehabilitation City Project 2107. We'll use the same format, start with the staff report and then followed by questions from council. I will open up the public hearing. Anyone who would like to speak on the Jarvis Area Pavement Rehabilitation Project will have 3 minutes to speak to the council. When we're concluded hearing from everyone, I will then close the public hearing. Staff will have an opportunity to respond to any questions that were presented during the public hearing, and then council will have a discussion and consider the motion that's been placed before us. So, Mr. Jarosz, I'm going to turn this over to you.
Thank you, Mayor, Council. The second project I'm here to talk to you tonight about is the Jarvis Area Pavement Rehabilitation, City Project 21-07. The streets included with this project are shown on the screen. They include Jarvis Avenue from Barclay Street over to White Bear Avenue, Barclay Street from Jarvis Avenue up to the cul-de-sac, Sexton Avenue from Barclay Street over to Hazelwood Street, Flandreau Street from Jarvis Avenue to the cul-de-sac, Jarvis Court from Jarvis Avenue to the cul-de-sac, 11th Avenue from White Bear Avenue over to Ariel Street, and then Ariel Street from County Road C down to the cul-de-sac just north of Highway 36. And it's worth noting that Ariel Street is a border street with the City of North St. Paul, and city staff have been coordinating with them and will be continuing to coordinate with them as the project progresses. This project totals just under 2.5 miles in length. The average PCI rating of these streets is just a 33 out of 100. Oh. So again, on that scale from 0 to 100, with 100 being a brand new road, these rated just a 33. It's worth noting that when a street gets under 55 out of 100, we consider it in poor condition. So these ones are in really rough shape. The pavement has again deteriorated to the point where general maintenance is no longer possible or cost effective. The majority of the concrete curb and gutter, however, on this project is in good condition. The Maplewood-owned utilities, the storm sewer and sanitary sewer, are also generally in good condition with only minor repairs needed. But St. Paul Regional Water Service, as well as the City of North St. Paul, have identified some sections of the cast iron water main that are in need of replacement. With this project, we sent out an informational packet back in November of last year. That included the project location map, frequently asked questions brochure, and assessment information, as well as that neighborhood meeting number 1 invitation. That first neighborhood meeting was held on November 23rd. We mailed that invitation out to 121 properties with eight property owners attending the meeting. Again, we had a presentation on the project scope, project timeline, how much the project would cost and funding sources, as well as assessment information and resident communication. And we followed that up with a question and answer session. The majority of the conversation during that session revolved around property access during construction, the current state of the pavement, the general construction process, as well as general questions on assessments. Staff held a second neighborhood meeting last week to bring residents back up to speed before tonight's public hearing. We reviewed that information that we discussed at the first neighborhood meeting, and we answered any remaining questions. Only three residents attended that meeting, and there was no questions asked at the end of that meeting. And additional neighborhood meetings will be scheduled as the project progresses. So with this project, we're mainly focused on that street pavement. We're looking at grinding up that existing street pavement and reclaiming it to create that new solid road base, installing two new layers of asphalt pavement, doing spot replacement of the concrete curb and gutter. So with this project, we're just looking at replacing that severely deteriorated curb, curb that will no longer properly support the edge of the street pavement or has sunk or heaved and is causing a drainage issue in the roadway. We look at replacing those as part of the project. We're looking at minor storm sewer system repairs, just the replacement of a couple catch basins, as well as adjusting the utility castings, so your sanitary sewer manholes, raising those up to the final street elevation. And then the cast iron water main, like I said before, is in need of replacement in select areas. So St. Paul Regional Water Service has notified us that the water main under Jarvis Avenue between Barclay Street and Hazelwood is in need of replacement, as well as the water main under 11th Avenue from White Bear Avenue over to Ariel Street. And then the city of North St. Paul has determined that the water main in portions of Ariel Street is in need of replacement as well. We are also proposing the addition of a sidewalk on the north side of 11th Avenue to fill in a missing segment there. There's an existing dirt path that's been beaten into the grass on the north side of 11th Avenue between White Bear Avenue and Ariel Street. So we're looking at filling that in as part of this project. It's also worth noting that the city of North St. Paul did notify us recently, just last week, that they are looking at the addition of a sidewalk along the east side of Ariel Street. So the North St. Paul side of Ariel Street, they're looking at installing a sidewalk from County Road C down to 11th Avenue. But the costs included with that or involved with the installation of that sidewalk would be borne by North St. Paul. Overall, this project is estimated to cost just over $4.1 million. With the project funding sources shown on the screen, the Street Revitalization Fund, so those are the gas franchise fees that were implemented back in 2013. Those will be utilized to fund this project. That's what they were put in place for, was these pavement rehabilitation projects. There's the assessments to the benefiting properties, the various utility funds to pay for the improvements to both systems, the general obligation improvement bonds, and then contributions from St. Paul Regional Water Service in the city of North St. Paul are estimated to fund just over $1.2 million of this project. So a significant contribution from those two entities. So as we saw in the previous slide, assessments are just one of the funding sources the city utilizes to finance these public improvement projects. Each year, the city council sets a maximum rate based on the type of project. And then during the design phase, the city hires an independent appraisal firm to determine what the actual benefit is that's received by the properties. And per state statutes, that assessment amount cannot be greater than the benefit to the properties. And that appraisal process is underway right now. We'd look at hosting an assessment hearing in September of the year. And that would be the meeting at which residents can directly address the council in regard to the assessments. And prior to that assessment hearing, residents will be mailed an official statement of assessment, which would include the amount of their assessment, options for paying the assessment, the ability to defer the assessment, as well as the right to object to the assessment. And leading up to that hearing, we would hold an additional neighborhood meeting to answer any questions residents might have in regards to the assessments. So council received the feasibility study back on January 24th and approved that report. We held a second neighborhood meeting just last week, leading up to tonight's public hearing. And this is the meeting at which residents are able to provide direct input to the council on the proposed improvements. And after receiving that input, the city council would vote on whether or not to order the improvement. And just a reminder that that does require 4 affirmative votes. If approved tonight, we would finalize design of the project and send plans out for bids, looking to award a construction contract in the late April timeframe. We'd host an additional neighborhood meeting in May, leading up to construction to inform the residents about the construction process and answer any questions they might have. Construction will commence between June and October of the year, and then we'd hold that assessment hearing in September. So with that, staff is recommending that the City Council hold the public hearing and take public input on the project. After taking into consideration that public input, staff is recommending approval of the resolution ordering the improvements for the Jarvis Area Pavement Rehabilitation Project. And just that final reminder that 4 affirmative votes are required to approve the resolution tonight. With that, staff is available for questions.
Thank you, Mr. DeRoche. Let's see if council has any questions. I think I've asked mine on the COPE project, and I know that they apply as well to Jarvis. Councilmember Knutson.
Just affirm an observation that we're doing 2-point-some miles here in a much smaller scope on the COPE Avenue, but it looks to me like the COPE Avenue, because you're redoing road widths and stuff like that, is a little more costly per mile or per foot or whatever the way you want to look at it. Is that a correct observation?
Councilmember Knutson, yes, that is a correct observation. Also on the COPE Avenue project, we're replacing all of the water main. And replacing all of the curb and gutter there. So that one is, although we're calling it a pavement rehabilitation, it kind of sprung into much more than that as we got into the feasibility process and has turned into more of a, you know, borderline full reconstruction project. So yes, the cost per mile for COPE is significantly more than this project.
Thank you.
Councilmember Cave.
Yes, Mr. DeRoche, just one question, and it's about the water main. What type of protections or plans do we have in place if you start this project and you find out the whole thing, like COPE needs to have the water main replaced, not just parts?
It's a good question, Councilmember Cave. So as part of the feasibility process, we partner up with St. Paul Regional Water Service, as well as North St. Paul on this project. And we ask them to evaluate their system and determine which sections need to be replaced. So the portions that we're not looking at replacing on this project consist of a different material. It's ductile iron pipe, as opposed to the cast iron pipe that we're looking to replace. The cast iron is much more brittle and susceptible to breaking in the winter with the frost. The ductile iron is slightly more malleable and tends to resist cracking and breaking much better. So we rely on those experts to guide which systems need to be replaced with these projects.
Okay, but if by chance we get down there and then somebody's like, you know, we need to do replacement, is this something we can go to St. Paul Water for assistance with help with that too?
Councilmember Cave, correct. So if they determine that additional water main needs to be replaced during the project, that would be a cost that would be borne by St. Paul Regional Water.
Okay, thank you.
Yep.
Councilmember Villavicencio.
Thank you. I think it's obvious that if it's a 33 out of 100, that it's a necessary project. But I was wondering, just a reminder for a lot of residents and myself, because I think, a lot of people tend to want to know, like, how do we prioritize which roads get done over others? And so I was wondering if you could remind us what the PCI rating stands for and briefly what it means.
That's a great question, council member. So each year the city sends out staff to rate 1/3 of these streets throughout the city. So we send people out there and they're literally counting cracks on the roadway, the type of cracks and the severity of those cracks. And we take all that information, we plug it into a computer program, and it spits out that pavement condition index rating. So we utilize that information to really guide our capital improvement plan process. at least from the first glance. And then on top of that, we look at things like the utilities. Is there a water main that's in need of replacement in this area? Is there drainage, storm sewer issues, or sanitary sewer type issues? As well as we take in resident feedback, and we track resident feedback in areas on complaints we get on potholes and issues with the utility system. So we take all of that information, and that guides our process with prioritizing projects for that capital improvement plan.
Any other questions, Councilmember Villavicencio?
No, thank you very much.
Okay, Councilmember Juniman?
No questions, thank you.
And I have none as well. So let us move on to the public hearing. And I will open up the public hearing concerning the Jarvis Area Pavement Rehabilitation City Project 21-07. Mr. Folds, can we have our other screen, please?
Yes, Mayor. I will stop the sharing. Thank you, John.
And do we have anyone on the line for the Jarvis project? I believe we had one.
We do, Mayor. Mr. Horniker, you're now able to speak if you'd like to give public comment on this item.
Thank you. I appreciate it. Yeah, I'm happy that the road is going to be worked on. It's great news. My questions really pertain to the phasing of the project and the preserving of access and water on Gervais Avenue during the course of construction.
Okay. I'm making note of them. So phasing of the project and access for water and basic access, I guess. Is that what you're asking as well?
Yeah. So, I mean, I work for Cub Food. So, you know, we want to make sure we have access, appropriate access to the store during the course of construction.
Okay. Great questions. Anything else? What we'll do when we're done with when I close the public hearing, then staff will be able to respond to your questions.
Sure. No problem. Okay.
Any other questions that you have?
Not right now. Thank you.
Okay. Is there anyone else, Mr. Folds, who would like to join us for the public hearing?
Mayor, the only other caller that is on the line is the caller that spoke about giving public comment regarding scooters.
Okay.
I can certainly unmute them to see if they would like to give public comment on this item, or we can move.
Okay. Why don't you, since they're on the call anyway?
Sounds good. Caller with the last four digits of 9788. If you would like to give public comment on the Jarvis Street Project, please press star 6 to unmute.
No, thank you.
Okay.
Thank you very much. Mayor, there's nobody, no one else on the line.
All right, thank you. So I will close the public hearing. Mr. Jaros, did you hear Mr. Horniker's questions?
Yes, Mayor, Councilor, I did take note of his questions. Would you like me to go through them?
Would you please?
Yes.
Thank you.
So the first question was in regards to general access during the project. And I understand this resident or this property owner is at the Cub Foods property, but in general, this project is going to be constructed under through traffic conditions. So we're going to maintain access to the adjacent properties for the vast majority of the project. Now, that being said, when a piece of concrete curb and gutter or driveway access has to be replaced as part of the project, which I know the access into that Cub Foods parking lot needs to be replaced off of 11th Avenue, it's in really rough shape. What we'd look at doing there is we would pour that access in half. So we construct it in two halves so that while one is curing, the other portion of it can be utilized to for vehicles entering and exiting the site, and then we'll flip-flop that after the one side is cured and replace the other side. So we will do that with the properties that we're able to do that with throughout the project. Cub Foods, I believe, also has the additional access off of White Bear Avenue, as well as Home Depot and some of those other properties. As far as the water system is concerned, St. Paul Regional Water or the City of North St. Paul, they'll be setting up temporary water mains before the existing water main is removed. So they'll establish a new water system above ground that'll continue the water feed to the properties throughout the project. There'll be a short downtime when the new system is hooked up to the building and the old system gets disconnected, but they coordinate that with the property owners to make sure it isn't causing a major disruption to their operation there. So that would be done by St. Paul Regional Water Services. I think that's all his questions.
I think those were the questions. Do you want to go over a little bit about what you talked about during the COPE project when I asked you about notification of businesses?
Yes. So similar to the COPE project, with this project, obviously we have a number of commercial businesses along here. So we are going to do everything we can as part of the project to ensure that those businesses operations can continue uninterrupted. So we do have the regular information that's going to go out via mail on the project website, and then the, you know, door-to-door type hangers. And we also are going to have a staff person this summer dedicated to working with the businesses, both on the COPE project and the Jarvis project. Their job is going to be to coordinate with the property owners on a weekly basis, just to ensure that their needs are being met and we're not causing any, you know, unintended harm to their operations as part of the project.
Okay, thank you very much. I think you covered all the questions. So thank you very much. Let's see. Now, in terms of council, let's see if there are any other discussion questions or comments from the council before we take a vote. Councilmember Knudsen.
No questions.
Councilmember Cave.
No questions.
Councilmember Villavicencio.
No questions.
And Councilmember Juniman.
No questions, thank you.
Okay, then that wraps up our questions. Council members, is there a motion concerning the Jarvis Area Pavement Rehabilitation Project?
I motion to approve the attached resolution ordering the improvements for the Jarvis Area Pavement Rehabilitation Project City Project 21-07.
Second.
Moved by Cave, seconded by Juniman, the motion to approve the attached resolution ordering the improvements for the Jarvis Area Pavement Rehabilitation Project 21-07. Is there any further discussion? Hearing none, then let's go to a vote. Councilmember Knudsen.
Aye.
Councilmember Cave.
Aye.
Councilmember Villavicencio.
Aye.
Councilmember Juniman.
Aye.
And I vote aye as well. The motion passes. We have no unfinished business tonight. Moving on to new business, we have one more street project that's just a step behind. This is the McMenemy Street project. Mr. Love or Mr. Jaroche, which one of you has this one?
That's me again, Mayor. Would you like me to take it off?
Go ahead.
All right. The final project here tonight is the McMenemy Street Improvement City Project 21-02. The extents of this project are McMenemy Street from County Road B on the north all the way down to Larpinder Avenue on the south. So this street totals right around 1 mile in length and has an average pavement condition index rating of 43 out of 100. The pavement on this street is also deteriorated to the point where it's no longer cost effective to patch or just maintain that street. This street differs from the past two projects in that it lacks concrete curb and gutter along the sides of the street. The storm sewer system along here is also deficient. It has deteriorated in some areas. It includes a localized ponding of water on the roadway. And St. Paul Water, similar to the other two projects, has identified that most of the cast iron water main under McMenemy Street is in need of replacement as well. And then staff did note that there's a lack of pedestrian and bicycling facilities along McMenemy Street. As far as resident communication on this project, we hosted the first neighborhood meeting back in December of last year. And at that meeting, we sent out an invitation to approximately 166 property owners, and 12 property owners attended that first meeting. We had a presentation similar to the past projects, followed up by a question and answer session. The majority of the conversation on this project revolved around the proposed sidewalk or trails along the street, concerns over the removal of trees that might have to happen in order to install a sidewalk or trail, property access questions. There was some notes of speeding issues along the corridor, concerns with the condition of the pavement, and then just general questions on the construction process, as well as the assessments. And then staff did mail out an informational packet to the project area in January of the year, which included a project location map, a frequently asked questions brochure, information on the assessments, as well as an invitation to the second neighborhood meeting, which we're looking at holding on the 24th. And that will be a meeting at which any questions that are remaining from residents will be answered leading up to the public hearing. So on McMenemy Street, we are proposing a full reconstruction of the street. So that would include removing the existing street pavement, as well as the material underneath the roadway. We'd look at installing a new aggregate base, a new sand drainage layer underneath the roadway, to ensure that we're getting any moisture out from underneath that roadway to prevent that freeze thaw action that we see in Minnesota. On top of that aggregate base, we'd install two new layers of asphalt pavement. Staff is recommending the installation of concrete curb and gutter on both sides of the street to support that edge of that street pavement, as well as channel the runoff and get it to the storm sewer system, and also to better contain vehicles and the snow plows within that street section. We are recommending an expansion of the storm sewer system to better remove runoff from the street and get it down to the pipes and into the area storm sewer system and ponds. We are recommending the cast iron water main be replaced as determined by St. Paul Regional Water Service. And then we are recommending as part of this project an 8-foot asphalt trail along the east side of McMenemy Street to connect the area to the trail systems. We have the large trail system on the north side along County Road B that currently goes from 35E all the way over to City Hall here around Keller Lake. And eventually we'll go over to Rice Street when it's fully built out. And then down on the St. Paul side, there's the large trail system down along Wheel Lock Parkway. So we're recommending that 8-foot asphalt trail to, you know, connect those two trail systems, but really to tie the area into the larger trail network. This project is estimated to cost $5,448,000. With project funding coming from the sources shown on the screen, which include assessments to the benefiting properties, the sanitary sewer fund, environmental utility fund for drainage improvements, general obligation improvement bonds, and then significant contributions again from St. Paul Regional Water Service of just over $1.1 million. It is worth noting that this feasibility level estimate is roughly $1 million over the CIP estimated project cost. However, this project, the majority of that is reflecting the additional water system improvements and drainage improvements that are needed that were identified during the feasibility stage. A large portion of those are covered by St. Paul Regional Water again. And then the city was successful in obtaining the maximum amount for the local road improvement grant from the state of $1.25 million. And that does, the combination of those things does make it so that the bonding levels are at roughly $1 million under what we estimated during the CIP process. So looking at the project schedule, council is here tonight to receive the feasibility study. If it is approved tonight and the public hearing is ordered, we'd host a second neighborhood meeting on February 24th to answer any remaining questions. We look at hosting that public hearing on the council meeting on February 28th. And that will be the meeting at which residents can provide input on the proposed project directly to council, and council would vote after that on whether or not to order the improvement. If we move forward at that point, staff would design the project and send those plans out for bids. We look at awarding a construction contract, same time frame as the other projects in late April, host an additional neighborhood meeting to bring residents up to speed on the construction process in May. And then construction would happen in that June to October timeframe again, with the assessment hearing happening in September of the year. And that will be the meeting at which residents can voice their opinions directly to council on the proposed assessments. So with that, staff is recommending approval of the resolution accepting the feasibility report, authorizing the preparation of plans and specs, and calling for a public hearing at 7 p.m. on the 28th for the McMenemy Street Improvements City Project 21-02. With that, staff is available for questions.
Thank you, Mr. Jaroche, for that report. Let's see if council has any questions on our third project. Mr. Councilman Knudsen.
Yes, Mr. Jaroche, does that 8-foot trail instead of a sidewalk?
Councilmember Knudsen, that is correct. We are proposing an 8-foot wide trail, a multi-use trail on that side. So that would be the idea behind that would be for pedestrians and bicyclists.
Okay.
And looking at the existing street, we look at mimicking actually what's there right now. It already has 11-foot driving lanes and then 2 5-foot shoulders on each side. So the 5-foot shoulders, similar to that COPE project, can be utilized for both bicyclists and pedestrians.
Good. Thank you. Makes sense.
Councilmember Cave. Just one comment. John, thank you, Steve, and your staff. You guys have done an amazing job with all these projects. They're all very much needed. And also, great job on getting the improvement grant. People don't realize how much work has to go into getting a grant. And, you know, our community and the citizens who benefit from them, sometimes they don't realize how much work you guys do for that. So I commend you and thank you to your team.
Thank you very much. We'll pass that along to them.
Thanks. Good point. Councilmember Villavicencio.
No questions.
Councilmember Juniman.
Just actually one question and one comment. I think I've been at this too long because we have the the report from the engineer with the soil evaluations, and I'm actually fascinated what's wrong with this picture. But when you see that, when you see how the soils are and you see that that road never had storm sewer, it all starts to make sense. Although sometimes you wonder how could it last as long as it did. It's amazing, actually. I have a question about, because you said there are several places where there are trees involved and so on, and I've had one resident who's asked me a couple of times about saving some trees. And do you bring in the environmental planner or the natural resources coordinator about if these trees should be saved or how to save them or whatever? Because there are some species that may have already outlived their, shall we say, environmental usefulness. And I know in one case it's spruce trees, and spruce trees have a limited life here. And they are also now susceptible to a very bad fungus that is basically destroying all the spruce trees in Minnesota. So do you bring them in when you're talking about how to save trees or if to save trees or whatever?
Councilmember Juniman, yes, it's a good question. So we do harness our staff that we have available here, our experts on trees, when necessary. I mean, I will say, first and foremost, we do everything we can as part of the design to avoid tree removals.
Right.
So with the particular case that the resident that contacted me as well, we are going to look at shifting that trail as close to the curb. It's probably going to be right on the back of the curb in the end, in order to minimize the impact to the trees in that area. However, those trees are planted very much, very far out into the right of way. So it's it may not be possible to save all of them, but we're going to do everything we can to save
and
them.
I did look and they are spruces and I don't know how much of their life is left. So
yes, you know. And we provide great screening for that resident on McMenemy Street. We totally get that and we totally value that as well. And we want to save them to the extent possible. So we're going to be working with that resident on what options are available. It's likely going to end up with, we're going to be able to save some of the trees, not all of them. And then we'd offer replacement trees that we can put somewhere on the property to refill in that screening over time.
Oh, thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Yes, thank you for those efforts. That's I believe I got an email from that same resident about the trees. So thank you. I really appreciate hearing your comments about that. So council members, is there a motion?
I move approval of the resolution ordering your improvement, the improvement project for the McMenemy area streets, calling for a public hearing to be named later.
Is there a second?
Second.
Moved by Juniman, seconded by Knudsen. The motion to approve a resolution accepting the feasibility report, authorizing the preparation of plans and specifications, and calling for a public hearing at 7 p.m. on February 28th for the McMenemy Improvement City Project 21-02. Is there any further discussion? Hearing none, then let's hear from Council Member Knutson. How do you vote?
Aye.
Councilmember Cave?
Aye.
Councilmember Villavicencio?
Aye.
And Councilmember Juniman?
Aye.
I vote aye as well. The motion passes. Councilmembers, we now will have a little over 4.5 miles of road that will be improved this summer. Looking forward to that. So let's see, our next agenda item is Scooter's Coffee. Let's see, Mr. Thompson, I believe that this is yours, your report.
Thank you, Mayor. Can you hear me and can you see my screen?
Yes, we can.
Excellent, thank you. Thank you, Mayor and Council. Before I get into the development application that's been submitted to the city, I did want to give some background on this site and the city's history with it. It's a property located at the northeast corner of Highway 61 in the intersection of County Road B. It's actually a property that is owned by the city, and it was acquired by us as part of the 36 and English Interchange project. And the land that comprised our ownership came from some turnback of MnDOT right-of-way, some land that was owned by Menards, and then the former Keller Lake convenience store, which occupied the site, as you can see in this aerial photo before the improvements were built. As part of that project, it was a comprehensive project, but as part of that, it included a realignment and reconfiguration of the intersection of Maplewood Drive and County Road B. Go to the next slide here. And here on the screen in the aerial photo, you can see the post-construction condition with the realigned intersection moving further to the east and further away from the controlled intersection at 61 in County Road B. And so that's the purpose of why the city acquired that land, was to facilitate that component of the project. And then after completion of the road project, the city took a number of steps to make the site development ready, because it was always part of the plan that we would acquire the property, construct the project, make it development ready, and then resell the land for future development. So some actions we took is we completed the demolition of the previous site improvements. There was some environmental remediation that was required that was completed. We actually incorporated stormwater management. We oversized the stormwater management to account for future development on this site. And then lastly, just last year, the platting or subdivision of the property to create the development parcel. So that's the kind of the background on the city's acquisition. And then back in 2021, August of 2021, the city signed a purchase agreement with Borostas to acquire the property and then develop a freestanding drive-through coffee shop on that site. Earlier this evening on your consent agenda, you did approve an extension to that purchase agreement, and that currently runs through April 2022. So it gives the applicant an additional potential of 60 days of extending the closing date. And then just to note, one of the contingencies is that continues in that purchase agreement is obtaining the entitlements from the city for the land use approvals, which really is what brings us here this evening. So as I mentioned, the applicant and purchaser of the property is proposing to build a one-story drive-through coffee shop. What's unique about it is it's entirely drive-through. There's no interior space of the restaurant for the public. It's an entire drive-through operation. The brand is Scooter's Coffee. It's a brand that's in the Midwest, but is new to Minnesota. And interestingly, it would actually be the second Scooter's built in the Twin Cities. The first is in Maplewood on Stillwater Road. And upon approval and closing of the property, construction is anticipated to begin later this summer and then opening early fall. So the land use approvals require three approvals from the council, first being design review, the second being a conditional use permit, and then third, a setback variance. And that's the agenda item that's before you here tonight. A little background on the land use and zoning. The site is guided in our comp plan for mixed use community and then is zoned consistently as M1, light manufacturing. The proposed use is allowed by both the comp plan land use designation as well as the zoning district, the permitted use, but our code does require a conditional use permit for any commercial use that's within 350 feet of a residential district. And that's because of the proximity to the single family homes to the east is the approval that's required by the conditional use permit. The as I mentioned, it's a drive-through operation. Just a quick overview on the site plan for the project. There would be a single access drive from Maplewood Drive. So there is no access proposed, of course, from 61, but also no access proposed from County Road B. So it'd be a single access point on Maplewood Drive. The site certainly has its constraints for development in terms of the layout, the three road frontages, some easements that are on the property. So that kind of drives a lot of the site design, but one of the priorities for the design is to certainly provide the maximum amount of interior stacking for vehicles for that drive-through as feasible. And we think that design has really accomplished it. The city actually doesn't have a formal stacking requirement for drive-through lanes, but this configuration has a significant amount of stacking for the drive-through because you have the whole, if you can see my cursor, but the drive-through would actually be located on the south side of the building along Maplewood, County Road B. And so you have the entire drive lane and then also the parking areas, which wouldn't be utilized by customers all the way out to the access drive. So there's a significant amount of stacking, more so than you probably see at other drive-through operations throughout the city, accounting for the exclusive use of the drive-through, but also some of the peak morning times that can, when people are frequently in a coffee shop. And then the building does meet all the setback requirements. To note, the variance that is being requested is for a very minor intrusion into the setback from Maplewood Drive. There's a diagram in my next slide highlighted in red. Given some of those site constraints, part of the drive parking area does extend into the required parking setback. And that's just to accommodate that the drive lane. It's really not for parking itself. And it's a pretty, as I said, minor intrusion into that setback requirement. And is there are practical difficulties as a result of some of those site constraints that I mentioned. The Community Design Review Board did review the design of the building. As a new commercial structure, it does require that design review. They did recommend unanimously approval of the project and did add two conditions that are included in your resolution this evening. The first, just ensuring that stormwater management off the roof of the building is appropriately managed, which is will be reviewed as part of our issuance of any building permits. And then second, that they, because of the meeting was held remotely online, they want to ensure that staff is reviewing the exterior building materials before the permit to ensure that they are consistent with what was noted on the plans and included on the building elevations. The conditional use permit and the setback variance require review. Before I get to that, just to note on the design review that the plans were reviewed by our environmental planner and our natural resources coordinator. They had a couple items of note for the council. One, they do recommend the final landscape plan be updated to provide some replacement tree and shrub species that are more appropriate for our climate here in Minnesota and are more appropriate for the site. They also think there's an opportunity for additional tree planting on the site to provide just some additional softscape materials and landscaping materials as part of the site design. And then secondly, Keller Lake is located to the west, so the property is actually within the shoreland regulations of that lake. And just to note that they are in compliance both with the setback, of course, there's quite a distance, but they also do, the site does meet the 40% maximum impervious surface coverage that's included within the shoreland district. And those conditions that are included in the environmental report, and we have also included the engineering comments that are included in the review by the city's engineering staff. And then there were two comments included from our neighborhood survey. I know there was also a resident that came to the public hearing at the Planning Commission and testified. And those, again, were included in your packet for your consideration. Now, on the Planning Commission, as I mentioned, the conditional use permit and variance require the public hearing before the Planning Commission. That was held on January 18th. They did recommend approval of the project. There was quite a bit of discussion about the vehicular traffic and some of the things I noted earlier in my presentation. And they did recommend the council include a condition that a traffic study be completed 1 year after approval by the council. We've not included that in your resolution just because it's a very unique application of a traffic study. We do, of course, review all conditional use permits at a minimum 1 year after the issuance to ensure that the conditions are met and that any adverse additional impacts are addressed on the site. And so we think that's adequate to ensure that the site is operating and the operator is managing the traffic conditions as they intend. So that is not included in your resolution. That Planning Commission recommendation is not included in the resolution, but should you want to include it, there's language in your staff report indicating how to do so. So with that, staff is recommending approval of the land use applications submitted to the city. And I'm happy to answer any questions that the council may have.
Thank you, Mr. Thompson, for that report. I'm going to open this up for council comment. And then I know that Ms. Dupre was on the line. After that, we have council questions of you. I am going to then permit Ms. Dupre 3 minutes of time to make her presentation. Mr. Thompson, please clarify for me, did Ms. Dupre have an opportunity at the Planning Commission as well?
Yes, they did receive the public hearing notice, and I know that, yes, they did testify at the public hearing at the Planning Commission.
Okay, because I know that there are included written comments in here. So let us go to council questions. Councilmember Knutson, do you have any questions for Mr. Thompson?
I, as a liaison, was listened to the deliberation on this. And I just want to clarify, I think the commission did understand that the review of traffic would occur prior to the 1 year reapproval of the conditional use permit. So I think I was pretty clear that that was the way this the way it would be evaluated. And I think the developer gave some really good answers relative to traffic and stacking. The design of the facility looks like it could stack quite a few cars and had some opportunity for some flex if he needed to. So I think they did a good job of presenting, but I just wanted to clarify that my feeling was the commission understood that it would be reviewed prior to the 1 year reapproval.
Mr. Thompson, do you want to comment on that?
Mayor and Council, I think that's, I would agree that was the discussion at the Planning Commission.
Okay, thank you. Councilmember Cave. Councilmember Cave. Councilmember Cave, you're muted.
Hi, no, I was just kicked off. I had to re-enter Zoom. I apologize. I don't have any questions. I was wondering what Mr. Thompson said. So if he could repeat that, I apologize. I was kicked off Zoom.
Certainly. Mr. Thompson, could you repeat your comments?
Certainly. I think I was in response to Councilmember Knutson's
yes.
assessment. I just agreed that was the discussion at the Planning Commission.
Okay. That's what I wanted to know. So thank you. No other questions.
Councilmember Villavicencio.
Thank you, Mayor. I actually happened to listen to the Planning Commission meeting for that public hearing, and I happened to agree with the looking at the traffic study at another time, because I think there was a point made that's really valid, the fact that there's like construction going on at Menards. And so that when Menards is all the way done, the traffic patterns may change at that point. And so there may be a need to look at that traffic study and also pedestrian study in that area at that time.
Thank you. Councilmember Juniman.
Thank you, Mayor. About the whole traffic thing, I mean, this is, I suppose it'd be anecdotal, but is there any way to evaluate, I guess is the right way, whether this could generate more traffic than the former gas and convenience store did? I mean, that was a fairly demanding use of that location. So is there any way to equate or figure out if this is going to be a greater demand or not?
Mr. Thompson, can you reply to that?
Certainly, Mayor and Council, there are certainly empirical ways to analyze traffic generation comparisons between types of uses based on, you know, this kind of standard gas station and a standard drive-through coffee operation. There are models that could do that for us. It would be an exercise, and I say it's empirical because, you know, we obviously don't have true trip counts from the previous gas station to, you know, accurately say what the traffic was before. And then without the operation of scooters, it's also difficult for us to on the ground measure what the traffic would be. But there's certainly with traffic studies and traffic analysis ways to do kind of a study of anticipated trip generation for different types of uses. We have not done so, but yeah, there are ways to do so.
You know, that's maybe something we could consider. I don't know that we actually need to talk about a full-fledged traffic study, but I can't imagine that this does a greater, it may be different flow average, but I would think it would not be a greater number of cars.
That was discussed and the staff generally felt it would be similar.
Okay.
And certainly not greater, but it was it was a judgment. It wasn't any study done. It was just a judgment.
Right. Thank you, Bill. I appreciate that. And I also wanted to comment on the environmental review. This is one of those cases where I would say that we are saved by the environmental planner and the natural resources coordinator, because this is a landscape plan that apparently they didn't do their homework on what grows in Minnesota. So I'm hoping they understand that they have to work with these two people and that basically everything they submitted is inappropriate for here.
Right. And they were very receptive and appreciative during the discussion. I think I was going to comment too, it is a great service for our environmental department to, you know, to make these landscape plans consistent with Maplewood in Minnesota. And I think I've seen it a couple of times on design review. So good comment.
Thank you, Bill. And then the last comment in the environmental review was the landscape plan is minimal, add at least two trees or several shrubs to the north and south side of the property. That would help with the whole screening issue. And we do know that both trees and shrubs absorb a certain amount of noise. So not only the noise, this isn't going to generate any great amount of noise, I don't think, but it might help buffer from Highway 61. So I really appreciate that this landscape plan is as complete as it is. I think that both of our other boards did their homework. Thank you. I appreciate their input.
Mr. Thompson, I have a question about something that you said in terms of there's going to be a CUP review within 1 year of the project being completed, and that traffic would be considered in that anyway. Can you kind of explain that a little bit more?
Mayor, can you hear me okay?
Nope.
No,
you're a little quiet there.
Okay, give me 1 minute here. How about, is this better?
That's better. Thank you.
Thank you. So yeah, Mayor and Council, as part of any conditional use permit, the ordinance actually requires that the City Council review every conditional use permit within at the 1 year mark. And the general purpose of doing that is to ensure that they are complying with the conditions that were included in the conditional use permit resolution. So to the extent that, you know, the plan, so the if you go to the in your resolution, there are a number of conditions related to construction of the project in consistency with the plans, as well as meeting the conditions of the design review. Those are included in there. So those were the specific items we will review in 1 year. What that can include then is any sort of operational. We can certainly do a look at the site, as well as the observe the traffic operations to ensure that operationally that they are doing what they said they have done will do to manage the traffic on that site appropriately to not have adverse impacts on the city street network. So that's what we will review. What we won't do is a formal traffic study to anticipate if other site improvements may be needed to account for any sort of additional stacking. That's, I think, what we're trying to say is accounted for in the proposed site design, and it's difficult to change later on once the site has been constructed.
Right, I guess I'm kind of looking at it from the perspective that it's going to be reviewed anyway, and a traffic study a year out, what value will that have? A formal traffic study that doesn't it doesn't make a whole lot of sense to me, quite frankly. So I'm trying to understand that. Mr. Johnson, can you maybe answer the question? Why is it that the staff did not recommend a formal traffic study after a year of operation?
Mayor and Council, the reason we didn't is because the typical time, the standard time to do a traffic study is now as part of a development application. It's unusual to do it once the business is operated because it's very difficult to change the site design once the project's been built. So a traffic study is almost always done at this point in the design review and approval process. Mm-hmm. The reason we haven't done a formal traffic study is because, you know, we've looked at the proposed use, the roadway network, the site plan, and we think that the site can accommodate the traffic associated with the drive-through without adverse impacts on the public streets.
Okay, thank you. And would you say that when the changes were made to that intersection, that positively impacted what you're saying now?
Absolutely. Yes.
Okay. Okay, that makes sense. Council members, we've been through the round robin one time. I am going to give Ms. Dupre an opportunity to weigh in here, and then we will come back and we will go through our council round robin one more time. Mr. Folds, could you open up the line? I believe it was for the caller with the ending 9788.
Back to Mayor and Council. I am doing that right now.
Thank you.
And again, caller, just a reminder, yep, you got it. Thank you.
Good evening, Ms. Dupre. Welcome to the City Council.
Thank you, Mayor.
What is it that you would like to share with us?
Well, I hope that you all received the email that we sent out about the site, and a lot of our concerns were on that email. So I don't want to waste a bunch of your time, but listening today and on the other meeting that we were in on, what wasn't mentioned today was the one person on that design or the planning or whatever it was made a good comment about you guys, City of Maplewood, bought out the gas station and reconfigured that. And he thought maybe that spot should be left alone because of future traffic changes that are possible in, being 61 there. And then you'd have to buy out this guy
and tear down his building like he had to do for the gas station. So I thought that was a good point. Just to leave, of course, we would like to have the site left alone, maybe trees planted on it, whatever. Because we're the only ones that are affected by it, as you well know from our years of experience with Menards. And the traffic study also, why do it when Menards isn't going to be open? You know, all the traffic that goes by there now goes mostly to Menards anyway. So what good would a traffic study do when Menards is going to be closed down? And the stacking problem, which probably won't be a problem, but the problem is as they turn off of 61 on to B and then turn on to Maplewood Drive, and then they have to sit there and wait possibly for traffic that's coming from the Menards site. And so then the traffic would back up again onto County Road B. And likewise, when they leave the coffee shop to get back out onto Maplewood Drive, and then they have to sit there and wait for the cars coming and going on Maplewood Drive. And nobody's mentioned that. They just kept saying, they just keep talking about the stacking. How many cars can sit in the line to go through the drive-through? And nobody has brought up the fact that these cars coming and going have to turn onto Maplewood Drive. And the amount of traffic that Menards, there's bound to be some backup, at least in our estimate. And I had some other thoughts.
Do you receive our email?
Yes, I believe we all did. And we also received your comments that were provided at the public hearing.
At the public hearing.
Okay.
So, that was included as well. That's actually in our council packet tonight that we're all looking at.
Okay. All right. Well, this is Debbie Dupre. I also live here too. And I always say I'm going to be quiet, but you know, I can't do that. So so if you've already read the email, then you know all of our concerns.
I believe I do. I can't necessarily speak for other council members.
Yes. So will that get shared so they can see where we're coming from?
Didn't you send it to all council members?
Well, I did, but I didn't get, I really didn't get a response from anybody that they got it. And actually one came back from Rebecca. So I didn't, you know, I didn't know, I didn't get confirmation that anybody got it, but you know, I mean, we've been here for 100 years, right? So we're just trying to point out some things that are going to affect us. And they did mention that they wanted to open their store up at 5 o'clock in the morning. And our bedrooms are right next to the coffee shop. So I don't know, hours of operation are really important too, and where the kiosk is and everybody's radios booming and whatever sitting there waiting for their coffee and the smell of the coffee. And I guess that's it for me, unless you have a question for us.
I don't believe I have a question for you, but we're going to go back through the council members again.
Okay.
Okay, so why don't we do this? Is there anything else you want the council to hear before we go and deliberate?
Okay, do you want me to...
Well, we wouldn't have to at this point, but we will have another chance, right, when you have the... what do you call it, right?
I don't know what you're referring to.
When you open it up for
changing it so that they can get their variances, right?
And then we'll have a chance to talk when you open it up for comment.
We're going to, we'll go back to Mr. Thompson. I hope you're writing down some of those questions, Mr. Thompson, about kind of the next steps. Tonight, what's before us is a conditional use permit and setback variance, and then a motion to approve a design review resolution and project plans. So we'll go back and I'll ask Mr. Thompson. I just want to make sure we get all of your questions. And then Mr. Thompson, I'm going to ask him to answer some of those questions. And then we're going to go back and talk as a council and deliberate on the two motions before us tonight.
Okay. So if I quickly read.
Okay. Thank you, Mayor.
Okay. Thank you. Mr. Thompson, did you get those questions?
Yeah, Mayor, I maybe start with the traffic piece, which I think was the primary comment. So if we step back for a minute just to talk, I know I gave a brief overview of the history of the site, but that overall project for the realignment of the intersection of Maplewood Drive and County Road B was done to improve the traffic operations at that intersection. That was the primary intent of that design project. So we're confident that that the land would then be sold for a future commercial use. So we are confident that given those improvements that it will be an improvement over the previous conditions of how this site will operate, and that the traffic to and from the site, also from the access, not just the stacking internal to the site, but the traffic coming into the site and exiting the site will be able to be accommodated on Maplewood Drive without backing up on Maplewood Drive or out to County Road B. We're confident in that. That was the traffic question. The second piece was about hours of operation. Yes, there's no restrictions in there on their proposed on restricting them to their opening hours, so they would be able to be open at as early as 5 a.m. In the morning. So I think those were the primary comments or questions that I wrote
down. Those are the two that I wrote down. Those are the two that I wrote down. Okay. Just for a point, and maybe Councilmember Juniman might actually know the answer to this. As I recall, when it was a gas station convenience store, that was open really long hours. Because I used to stop there.
Yes.
Yes.
Councilmember Cave, maybe you know the answer to that too. I don't know.
Yes, it was.
It was open late.
Yeah.
It might have even been 24 hours. I don't know about that.
No, but I think it was open late.
Pardon me?
It was open late at night, I know.
Okay. All right. Thanks for that.
I don't think it opened until 6 in the morning, but whatever. It was open a lot.
Okay, thanks. So let's go back through a round robin for any other discussion concerning, we have two motions before us. So Councilmember Knutson, is there any other comments or questions that you have for Mr. Thompson?
My comment is over the past 3 years, as I've been doing a major construction project, I probably went through that intersection to Menards and around there 3 to 4 times a week at every time of day and night. And I can't recall any concern I had about traffic. And I think Menards has, you know, two entrances, two. And there's ample opportunity to get on a Maplewood Drive. Yes, you know, they'll queue up for the stop sign, but it moves rather quickly. So I've not observed any kind of concern whatsoever for traffic. And I think the point made about Menards closing for a year and doing a study is probably pretty difficult, but I support the project. I think it's a good one, and it's unfortunate that commercial zone, you know, is disruptive to other people, but it is in fact a commercial zone.
Thank you very much. Councilmember Cave.
I will make a couple comments. I would agree with Bill that the reconstruction of that Maplewood Drive does make that turn, you know, really nice, and it's not traffic congested there. I do have a question though with Mr. Thompson. Because the traffic is going to be going around that loop, and possibly the cars are going to be facing the homes. Is there going to be a buffer there for any lights?
Mayor and Councilmember Cave, there is a screening wall on that was built as part of the city project on the east side of the intersection of Maplewood Drive.
Okay, thank you.
Good question. Any other questions, Councilmember Cave?
No, ma'am.
Okay, Councilmember Villavicencio.
I guess I just have a comment saying that, you know, I am in general, in favor of the project. You know, I looked up the coffee shop. They are intriguing. You know, there's a lot of them in other parts of the country. I obviously love coffee. And I just think that, that, you know, it's just something that maybe we need to just keep our eye out for in the future if anything changes. Thank you.
Thank you. Councilmember Juneman.
Thank you, Mayor. I just think the traffic issue is kind of, it is what it is, and we've improved the intersection as much as it can be. And I think more issues have always been and will always be, if there are any, from Menards. I don't think this is going to be the backbreaker. I do have a concern, however, will down the line, will we be able to have a discussion about hours of operation?
Mr. Thompson.
I missed this. In the future, would there be a conversation about the hours of operation?
Yes.
Is that the question?
Yes.
I think if the council wanted to put hours of restrictions around the hours of operation, that should be done in the conditional use permit resolution.
Okay. Because I sort of do have a hang up of 5 a.m. considering that they aren't the only house, by the way. There is another house there just to the east of them. And that is fairly early for noise.
Mr. Thompson, did they report that they wanted to open it at 5 a.m.?
I believe that was stated at the Planning Commission meeting, correct?
Okay.
Certainly the council, if it's a concern, has the ability to set, as part of the conditional use permit, a earliest opening hour.
Yeah, I personally think it's a great idea, this coffee shop, and I don't see any of the other issues really being issues. I think the traffic was as fixed as it's ever going to be. And I don't think that is a big issue. And yes, there is a wall there and there's screening, but I do think 5 a.m. might be a tad early because there are houses. So I personally think we should make it 6 anyway.
What time does Caribou open down the street?
Mm-hmm. I believe 5.
Well, seems fair.
You know, I guess I have some difficulty limiting one coffee shop in town when we aren't limiting the other coffee shop in town.
I agree.
That's been our kind of our legacy, is to make sure we've got fair play for all commercial.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Okay. So I think that we kind of have gotten all of the issues fleshed out. And just to kind of get this moving, I agree that I think that the traffic patterns have been addressed when there was that big overhaul of County Road B and Maplewood Drive. I don't see a need for an additional traffic study. It just doesn't make sense to me. Menards is going to be closed for a year, and I mean, a traffic study is expensive, and we're not even going to see the patterns because Menards won't be open. I do not want to limit the time for opening because we aren't doing that for the other places in town. And I just don't think that is a fair playing field. So with that, I'm going to make a motion, the first one, to approve a resolution for a conditional use permit and setback variance for a proposed drive-through coffee kiosk at 2228 Maplewood Drive North.
Second.
Okay, moved by Abrams, seconded by Knutson. The motion to approve a resolution for a conditional use permit and setback variance for a proposed drive-through coffee kiosk at 2228 Maplewood Drive North. Any further discussion? Hearing none, then let's take a vote. Councilmember Knutson.
Aye.
Councilmember Cave.
Aye.
Councilmember Villavicencio.
Aye.
Councilmember Juniman.
Aye.
And I vote aye as well. And the second motion, would someone like to make that in terms of approving a design review resolution?
I move to approve a design review resolution and project plans date stamped December 21st, 2021 for the proposed drive-through coffee kiosk at 2228 Maplewood Drive North.
Second.
Okay.
Moved by Juniman, seconded by Cave. The motion to approve a design review resolution and project plans date stamped December 21st, 2021 for a proposed drive-through coffee kiosk at 2228 Maplewood Drive North. Any further discussion? Hearing none, then let's vote. Councilmember Knutson.
Aye.
Councilmember Cave.
Aye.
Councilmember Villavicencio.
Aye.
Councilmember Juniman.
Aye.
And I vote aye as well. And I would encourage staff, as they are working with the owners of Barostas, that you would encourage them to be good neighbors.
Yes.
So that they fit in with our community, and that they, you know, we want them to succeed in the community, but we want them to be good neighbors as well. Anything else, council members, on this? I know that this is a lot of moving pieces. Anything else, Councilmember Knutson?
Well, I was just reading, and I know that one of the members of the planning commission was very adamant. There's very concerned that this ought to stay natural, anticipating that sometime in the future we'd have problems with this intersection. And he was real adamant about it, but I think others kind of felt that, as we did, that this intersection had been worked pretty well and pretty thoroughly reviewed with the Kettle Lake situation and Menards and all that. But he just was very adamant. So just wanted to mention that. Anyhow, that's all.
Okay. Councilmember Cave.
No further questions. Okay. I agree with what you said, how, you know, we just want good stewards of the community.
Thanks. Councilmember Villavicencio.
No further comments. Thank you.
And Councilmember Juniman.
The only comment I would make is possibly in the future, if there are noise issues, there is such thing as adding more planting to help absorb noise. Mm-hmm. And at the 1 year conditional use permit, we can discuss that.
Absolutely. Good idea. Thank you, everyone. We have one more agenda item, the ordinance amending city code section 1-17. Mr. Thompson, this is yours as well.
Thank you, Mayor and Council. So we are bringing to you a brief amendment to the administrative citation, administrative penal offenses. As you'll recall, back in June of last year, we adopted our ordinance at that time to establish an administrative citation process. And the purpose is generally to provide a more effective and better enforcement tool for violations of the code. In that ordinance amendment, there were some exceptions listed, those were code violations to which we couldn't issue administrative citations. And after reviewing them and frankly, some code violations that occurred in the city around business licensing, we thought that we had probably unnecessarily tied our hands a bit and be able to use this tool for other types of violations in the code. And so in working with our city attorney's office, talking and working with the clerk's office who coordinates business licensing, We are recommending that the entire exception section just be struck from the ordinance to give us the greatest amount of flexibility in utilizing administrative citations for violations of the code. It certainly meets the intent of the council's policy direction that you've given to us to use this for enforcement. So that's the ordinance amendment that's in front of you. It just strikes the entire section. I would note it's not explicit in the ordinance amendment, but in the ordinance itself, it does not require any sort of enforcement action or any sort of, I should say, admission, always have to issue an administrative citation. There's always a recognition that this is an additional tool for any enforcement officer of the city to use, but we still have the discretion to determine if an administrative citation, a criminal citation, abatement, action on the license, whatever action is most appropriate in that violation, we'd still have the ability to do that. So it's just adding a tool onto the table. It's not taking any sort of tools off the table for enforcement action of the council or of staff as we enforce the ordinance. So that's the brief amendment we're proposing, and do recommend the council adopt the ordinance as included in your packet. And I'm happy to answer any questions.
Thank you. And I certainly remember the discussion when we were talking about adopting this new ordinance and what a good tool this would be. And, you know, whenever you make an ordinance change like this, sometimes we need to fine tune. This is new territory for us. So thank you for bringing this to our attention. Mm-hmm. Let's see if council members have any questions. Councilmember Knudsen.
No questions. My comment is I forgot about this. And in a couple of situations that Mr. Thompson and I have been working on, I think this is a great tool. I fully support this motion.
Thank you. Councilmember Cave.
I concur with Bill. I think I support it 100%.
Councilmember Villavicencio.
No questions.
Thank you. Councilmember Juneman.
Thank you, Mayor. Yes, I think it's a good tool, and I think it isn't just about businesses. Having had a couple, shall we say, undesirable places within two blocks of my house
for
quite some time, it would have been a nice tool then too. So there's going to be some of those also. So yes, I think it's a good idea. I support it.
Okay. So would someone like to make the motion?
I move the ordinance amending City Code Section 1-17 pertaining to administrative penal offenses.
Second.
Moved by Juneman, seconded by Cave. The motion to adopt the ordinance. I heard you first, Rebecca. Motion to adopt the ordinance amending Maplewood City Code Section 1-17 pertaining to administrative penal offenses. Is there any further discussion? Hearing none, then let's vote. Councilmember Knudsen.
Aye.
Councilmember Cave.
Aye.
Councilmember Villavicencio.
Aye.
Councilmember Juneman.
Aye.
And I vote aye as well. That is our last agenda item. And since we're still virtual, I'm going to give council members an opportunity if there's anything else they'd like to say before we wrap up for the night. Councilmember Knudsen.
Well, I think we need more variety. I'm kidding. This is an incredible agenda and just an incredible stuff we're working on. I just appreciate the opportunity to serve. That's
second.
All. You're seconding that? That's good, Rebecca. Okay, I'll third that. Okay.
I think it's bedtime.
I just had to. Happy Valentine's Day, everybody.
Yeah. Thank you. Anything else, Councilmember Villavicencio?
Nope, just happy Valentine's Day to everyone.
And Councilmember Juneman.
I'm with Bill. Could we get a little more variety here, please? We would probably get lost if we had any more variety. It's all I can
I
think it was, if you look this agenda, it was a pretty interesting night, actually.
Yes, it was.
And I have to say, it's always interesting to celebrate Valentine's Day with you guys.
I know, that's what I thought too. With that, I just want to wish everyone again a happy Valentine's Day. We are halfway through February now, and I see that we are pushing toward spring. The COVID numbers are improving. When I looked, yes, they were at 74. As you recall, we were looking at getting below 50 and seeing a pattern of being below 50. And I'm looking forward to coming back together in person. That should be, you know, just keep watching the numbers. I'm hopeful for maybe the end of March, the beginning of April. Let's keep watching the numbers. And finally, another harbinger of spring, our Arbor Day tree sale, yes, is was just announced in our Maplewood Living. In addition to approving three road projects that we know spring is coming, the Arbor Day tree sale really points us in that direction. So I just want to encourage anyone, if you would like a tree, they're really wonderful trees. Online ordering starts March 7th at 8 o'clock in the morning. We will have 150 trees available. And last year they sold out, as I recall, in hours, wasn't it? Mm-hmm. Yep. It was a very short period of time. I had people that, you know, waited actually for the second or third day and all the trees were gone. So if you're interested in a tree, go online and get ready, because you can start ordering March 7th. So with that, council members, I bid you good night and we are adjourned. Thank you, staff.
Thank
Bye,
you,
everyone.
Thank you. Night, everyone.